All right. Hello, everyone. This is Paul Haigh. Some of you know me as Game Master Pyro, coming to you from ITHERVERSE, the channel. This is our first ever Season 1, Episode 1 of A Blight of Souls. So anyway, let me take a second to introduce you to the crew. Now, I know some of you have been watching a previously recorded Session 0 where we started creating characters for a different group. That group's kind of on hiatus at the moment. So surprise! It's a different group. This is my crew from Orlando, my good friends. Raul Corona. Wave, Raul. Matt Stoddard. Guy with a beard. And his lovely wife. Excuse me. Can't talk. His lovely wife, Jessica Kenney. So, and yes, I did say wife. So, hands off, guys. I know. I'm sorry. You know, no emailing me trying to get her info. You're not going to get it. So, there you go. So anyway, before further ado, let me quickly warn everyone. I don't want anyone to say that I didn't tell you so. This is, in fact, very much an adult game. Adult language, adult content. I don't think we'll get terribly crude and rude. Well, then again, if it's funny, we may, but that's okay. But the point is, it shouldn't degrade into just a horrible F-bomb fest. It depends on how many horrible roles we make, but anyway, who cares? You've been told we're gonna have a good time, and that's what matters most. So jumping right into it, we are playing, of course, the ITHERVERSE version of Open D6, and we had a trial game last week and it went really well, so I think we're ready to jump into this. We'll take a second and let everyone kind of introduce their character. But doing so, just don't you know, not, obviously we're not looking for background information, things that other people wouldn't know. Each of the characters have met each other. Y'all have done a couple of jobs together. You're going to start tonight on a job together. But you know, nothing's ever happened. You're not running into any type of major action. So they're all level zero characters with no real experience to speak of. Having said that, we would like to know what your character kind of looks like, what people would see if someone were to just see them on the screen, what they would look like and what obvious visible gear they have and things, not what's tucked away in your backpack that you don't anybody know about. So anyway, any volunteers go first?
Sure.
Go for it.
Aiken is a elf ranger. So he's dressed and looks like a typical ranger, but he's got a bit of a belly, unlike most elves. And he's not quite as clean cut as what you'd expect from like Lord of the Rings or anything like that. But he, other than that, you're just imagine your typical elf ranger, and that's what he looks like.
Gotcha. Very good. Armed with, wearing anything visible, or is it all covered up by cloaks? And
so he's got a typical woodsman green, you know, cloak. Yeah. Blends in well in the forest. He's got a leather soft armor on and regular woodland garb, and he carries a bow. He's got a staff that he uses when he walks. He's got a couple of throwing knives and a long knife on his belt.
Okay, good. Sounds good. Well, you said Aiken. You kind of, not Aiken, Aiken.
Clay Aiken? What?
He's going to break into song.
Sure, we'll call him Aiken or Aiken. I don't care how you pronounce it. I'm not like some other people that games online.
Like, yeah, just get all pissed off because of what I called your character. Okay, yeah. good. Who is next?
I'm going to let Jessica go.
Okay.
Very nice.
My character's name is Paige. She's a young woman with fiery red hair and blue eyes. She's a little on the pudgy side, super curvy. She's dressed in sort of like, you know, almost ranger looking clothes, just a simple dress, leather armor. She's got a couple of knives on her belt, and she's got a bow and arrow.
Cool. We'll see what she's capable of as we go. Let's see. I was trying to see if there's anything else about her, but you covered all the important parts. All right, Mr. Corona.
All right. Mine is Ruin. Basically 6'3". I don't know, fairly built guy, probably looks like a mercenary or something. Pretty much standard garb with a cloak, probably two blades at his side. That's about it for weapons visible. Striking blue eyes, probably the easiest notable feature, but other than that, standard looking young dude, probably 23 or so.
Oh, very good.
So not so emo, but close, maybe.
Oh, okay.
Do you have a sweet emo haircut?
I have no idea. I haven't thought that far.
He does now. If you don't decide, others will decide for you.
We'll leave it up to the audience to take a poll.
There you go. That's good. Speaking of which, audience, feel free to contact us in the chat log. We're going to try to play, if not every week, every other week. That's kind of the idea behind this. It'll have to adjust. We all have real jobs behind all this. So we will try to announce what the plans are as we go along, in which we get this kind of more stable. But I'd love to see your feedback. If you go to the Itherverse website, itherverse.com, you can certainly log in there, email me directly, and then the players don't see it. If you post in the actual comments for the video, you know, everybody will see it, but you can let me know what you'd like to see happen. If you got any great vicious evil ideas you might like to see these characters introduced to, I'm all about hearing about those. So
Send them to me and I will bet.
to ruin at itherverse.com, which is not going to work. But anyway, speaking of which, we might eventually set up some methodology to reach out to the players if you want to try and reach out to them through the website. Haven't given that any thought yet. That's a good idea. So let's kind of get started. As you know, for most of you, I think I've at least mentioned this, you're going to be starting out in the Duchy of Rodolfo. It's the kind of the southeasternmost duchy of the realm. And a duchy is kind of like a state, if you will. There is no kingdom. None of the race wars of many, many years past led to so much ruin over time that the races have kind of come together and they've started working together much better. There's still some animosity, but there's no way to really elect a single king with all these different races. Which race would it be? Who would they represent? So, so everything's still fairly sectional at the duchy level, which is typically ruled by a duke or a duchess. And then there are further subdivisions geographically, like a duchy could be divided into shires, if you want to think of that, like counties. And then beyond that, your cities are, well, if they're big enough to be walled, they're usually considered a barony because it's not just the city, but all the suburbs around it. So that becomes a barony. And you, again, are starting in the capital city of the Duchy of Rodolfo, which is called Tallhouse, is the name of the city. And matter of fact, I have a quick map I can show you of what the capital city looks like. You guys should see that on your screen. If not, tell me. But it should not remind you of cookies.
Tall house.
I gotcha. Took me a second, and I'm looking at that. Does not look like a cookie. But a rather large city, obviously. One of the few capital cities to survive the great cataclysm of 217 years ago, which is when the current calendar started. But a very diverse city. If there's a place where there's a lot of racial diversity and there's a lot of acceptance, this is kind of it, as far as what part of the realm you know of. And you were all drawn here to the city for your own reasons. That's in your individual backgrounds. If you haven't decided that yet, you can do so later. It's not critical to today, but you have found your way here for work, most likely. Spent most of your time working in small jobs, individually, not even together, delivering packages, delivering memos, guarding warehouses, just really, really boring stuff. And nothing's ever happened in these missions. That's, you know, they'd be great if any excitement ever happened, but they haven't. But it's just enough coin to get by. You typically don't even sleep in the city because you're going to pay for a room or you're going to buy a meal at an inn. Not if you can help it. You can certainly camp outside the gates or, you know, camp cities outside the gates where you can, and you can hunt in the forest and the fish in the streams and things of that nature outside. So you can fend for yourself. In many cases, you've done so if for only the reason to save coin, of which you have very little. Matter of fact, that's what kind of brought you to the point tonight for one of the first times. You guys have bumped into each other because you've picked up various jobs from various tavern owners and, like I said, warehouses and what have you. you bumped into each other, but you've actually gotten the opportunity to all work together tonight. You're working as a night watch. You picked up the night watch will bring on extra people during certain times when there's expected to be additional, you know, trouble in the city, and it's just a festival weekend. So they brought you on board, and you three have been assigned to patrol a park, basically. It's just a city park full of trees. One of the streams, one of the cleaner streams, have run through here. These streams become kind of sewers as they get farther and farther away from the middle of town. People have a tendency to throw stuff in them and use them as their sewage, and then the whole city supposedly is built on limestone, so it kind of washes underground and disappears, and the garbage goes with it. But one of the nicer streams is running through this park, and that's where I'll see if I can get you all together here in just a second on the same page. Now, having said that, it's dark. It's late at night. And if I recall, none of you have elected to have any type of special vision. So I would assume someone is carrying a torch, or all of you maybe. It's up to you. You're just kind of guard duty in this
park. I thought elves in this world had dark vision.
I didn't know
that was supposed to be.
Yeah, you choose that. Yeah, you choose that on the sheet. Now, having said that, you can certainly do so. It is not an advantage or a disadvantage. It's considered kind of both, because if you want to have, and the same thing with what I call gray vision, or kind of a low light vision, where you're not completely, you can't see in complete darkness, but you can see as long as there's a light source. You can see better than someone who doesn't have one. So if you so want to do that, we'll go ahead and add that to your sheet now. We can make those changes while you're before you level up. And as usual, by the time you get to your first level, I let you adjust and make some changes to your character if you need to. And after that, you're kind of locked in. So did you prefer your character have some type of low light, what I call gray sight, or whatever you want to call it?
Yeah. No, I was assuming that he just had that. I didn't realize I needed it on the sheet. So
that's fine. Yeah. And I should have mentioned it to you before now. So, and I just added it to page the mage. Wrong sheet. But we'll assume so. Now, having said that, that doesn't help your two, I believe they're both human counterparts. So that helps you see, but not them.
So we're watching the park, right? And it's in the middle of this big city.
Yeah, you're just kind of patrolling around this woodsy, grassy park, if you will.
So isn't there some kind of lighting throughout the park itself?
No, it is completely dark in this grassy park. So it's not the kind of park that people browse through at night. There are no sidewalks. There are no improvements. Matter of fact, there's an old set of ruins and part of the town. So, I got a 10-minute warning here. So,
I would probably hang back further so the light, the torchlight, probably wouldn't mess with the vision in the dark.
Well, that's fine. I understand. Not a problem. But is Paige going to be carrying a torch to be able to see?
Yeah.
It is a dark evening.
Yeah, I know. I probably would have a torch.
Gotcha. The good thing is you don't have to take that out of your inventory. It has been provided for you by the actual city watch, who has, you know, technically brought you, deputized you for the evening. So I need to set up.
Can't pay you, but we'll make you.
So what that does for you, that makes the elf able to see three times as far as he normally, and I just did that to ruin. So let me fix all this. And I can drop you on the page and you can see what you can see. So yeah, because of the fact that you have low light vision there, Mr. Elf, Aiken, the elf, you will actually be able to see three times as far as someone else will with the same amount of light. So, but you do have to have a light source in range. So this should make some sense here in a second. What you've decided then, and again, as this map loads, you might need to zoom out and zoom back in. So I'll tell you what, I got to fix something. We're going to take our first quick break. I'm going to pause the recording, and then we'll come right back in just a second. Okay? Yep. And I got to find the right button to stop the recording here. Okay, so you are in the park, and the three of you have kind of all decided to kind of gather up. There's been absolutely nothing going on. It's probably, you know, like 1 o'clock in the morning. It's dark. It's abysmally dark, overcast night. And you just kind of all gathered up here over next to the stream just to have a chat about how the three of you together, should you find a way to market yourselves properly, might be a better way of finding better work. So the jobs that you'd really like to be having are the type that a single person doesn't get. Like the job you got tonight, great, there's three of you, but there's absolutely nothing going on. And you kind of sidling into that conversation when you start hearing some kind of heated voices, a little bit louder than normal, coming from the northwest. And it sounds like someone's shouting at someone. What do you do?
So how much are we getting paid?
Probably a couple silver, not a huge amount of money. The currency or the economy, I should say, of a silver piece might put you up in an inn for a day with food, room, board. You can certainly eat well for a silver piece. That same silver piece would certainly buy you food for a much longer period of time if you were preparing it yourself and everything. So it's not a paltry amount, but it's only a couple days worth. It's not like a treasure trove where I could take the next year off and never have to work again, which that'd be more like 100 silver or 10 gold, if you will.
Okay.
So, yeah. Good question. Obviously affects what age is willing to risk. I didn't hear nothing. I'm looking. I heard it's the stream gurgling.
Could we hear what was being said?
You could not. I mean, you can, if somebody has some type of heightened senses or something and you want to try and stretch yourself, then let me know. But as far as I know, based on just your character creation, I can't think of any reason anyone would be able to pick up any more than just the fact there's some kind of distant shouting. Doesn't sound like it's terribly far away. Could be within, 50 yards, 40 yards, maybe. Hard to tell.
Does it sound like an argument
or just
a raised voice?
Yeah, it sounded argumentative. Couple of voices now as it continues, as you listen.
And what are we supposed to be doing out here, guys? I don't remember.
Wow, that's short memory.
I thought they were paying us to sit by this river and drink wine.
That's what I thought, too.
All they gave you was a torch. And said, hey, hang out in the park and take care of any problems. It's a lot of party goers this weekend. There's a lot of people, things happen. So you're just being paid to be the night watch.
Well, this is boring. I'm going to go see what's going on over there.
Okay. Anyone joining her? What's the plan?
I will go.
Sneaky-like and stuff. Yeah, maybe one of us should go quietly and just in case.
And who might that be?
They're going to see us coming with our torches.
That's why I'm staying with my torch.
They'll definitely see you coming with the torch because you were the one that somehow got surreptitiously volunteered to carry it.
It's like a priest over there.
Of course you go, psst, but then you can't see.
All right. See, the priest has the wine and everything, blessing it.
What makes you think I'm a priest?
the little onk icon, probably. Wrong. Blew that. As she drops an F-bomb on you or whatever the current vernacular would be.
Like, and say what she worshipped. What
makes you think I'm a damn priest?
I've been to that church before.
So did you decide who was going to be doing the sneaking?
I can sneak or attempt it. I'm curious to how bad this guy's going to do.
Well, you kind of...
It sounds like ruins thing, so he should go up there.
He's going to do some sneaking. All right, sir. So we'll need an appropriate skill check from you under agility. I'm sure you have a skill that might benefit from this as well. Yes, stealth. Well, that would be the one. Oops, wrong initiative.
That was poopy.
Yeah, that was a crit fail. That one.
I tripped and fell in the light.
That one takes away the six. You rolled a five.
So. You know how much I miss real dives right now?
Your real dice didn't roll any better than these do. So don't tell me that.
I give me a red one that can crit fail.
Well, you got one. You got the first one of the night. Yay, first one ever.
So, I should have done that. So, way to go.
Well, you do successfully advance. By the way, the light's obviously being blocked by the trunks of these trees, if you were wondering what the weird the weird blocking symbols are in your lights. The trunks are kind of doing that. And you move through the darkness just in time to hear kind of a screaming voice as a guy comes running right past you. You have zero light source up there and zero ability. I doubt very well you can see him. But you get the sense that he's probably steps just from the sounds that he's within, 15 feet of you, running from west to east. Ah! Leave me alone! I don't know what you want. Something along that line.
Now, go ahead. Does he just keep running?
You don't know. I mean, I'm kind of taking this almost in an initiative type standpoint, but we're not quite there yet. We're just going kind of in a 5-second intervals here. So he goes running past Raul within a few feet of Raul. He's not that close to you. You do hear him, and you do hear his exclamation. Wow, I can't speak tonight. As he's running by, but he's much farther from you, Matt. It sounds like he's probably.
Well, I can see him.
Oh, you can see him. Oh, that's right. You got that faded glow, so you can actually see him. So yeah, this guy comes running out there, and your night vision picks up on where he's at. You can tell, and he looks like he's going to continue. If that's answering your question,
okay.
Paige, can you see him?
Just barely.
Barely.
I can see Aiken, but I can't see him.
Oh, okay. You can't see Ruin either.
Ruin can't see anything. He's staring at the ground.
Ruin can barely see himself. He probably sees like a foot around himself.
That's why I crit failed, damn it.
That's why you crit failed. It's dark. You tripped over that trunk. So are you moving up, Aiken? Or are you staying back? Or you...
Or yeah, I want to intercept. No, I'm not going to shoot him. I want to try to intercept him as he goes by and like maybe trip him. Oh. So I think I'm going to run. I'm going to, run like in front of his path and try to intercept him and trip him up with my right there. I'm going to trip him up as he walks by, as he runs by with my staff.
So you're going to plot an intercept course. Okay. So Paige, you see Aiken turn and go and start running towards the northeast.
Probably go that way.
You're going to follow him behind him?
Yeah.
All right. So you make it to this intercept spot about the time he, he's getting close. But then it sounds like there's some footsteps coming behind him there.
That's what I would be waiting for.
You hear some more footsteps, and they're not making any sounds other than the sounds of running as they come up behind. I think they get just into your range there. Aiken, you see them come up dark. These are they're all human. The ones in are cloaks or dark cloaks that you can see at the edge of your vision there. Aiken, the hoods have fallen back because they're running, and you see they have swords drawn. The guy in the front, who's was screaming and running and heard first, you recognize him. Barely.
I do.
You do. And matter of fact, Paige, can you see him yet?
No.
No, okay. So you recognize him. Obviously I'm sharing some knowledge that your character will have. The rest do not unless you convey it. But he looks like...
him, right? I recognize this guy.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thanks for pointing to everybody where he is. But no, I'm just kidding. It's not a big deal.
Sorry.
Oh, that's where he's at.
He was blending in with the scenery.
Ping that again. I missed it. So yes, that is correct. The lightly colored guy. All right. Gotcha.
I'll keep that in mind from now on. Sorry.
Sure. Having said that, he looks like this guy called Narsif. He's like the local homeless drunk guys that typically nobody really pays a lot of attention to, even less so than they might someone else that you really were concerned about, because he has this, he told a story a long time ago about being abducted, not by aliens, but by a crazed clan of, you know, 6'7" women, and they were going to do awful things to him. So it sounds like him being abducted by aliens. It's a very similar story, and it was
smoosh.
It was received exactly the same way as one might be received if they told stories about being abducted by aliens and having probes done. So so people kind of steer clear of this crazy guy. But here he is in the...
He's a friend of mine?
No, I wouldn't call him a friend. Just someone you know, because he has a little bit of notoriety from his crazy story and the fact you've just seen him anywhere you... If ever you've stopped in any drinking hole in town, you know... It's just, he's one of those guys you see wandering around and...
Or snoozer.
And not surprised to see him in the park, but being chased by these guys saying, I don't have it, I don't know what it is, it's a little unique. So anyway, that's what you see.
What's his name again?
Narsif.
Okay.
So at this point, things are kind of getting to the point we better go ahead and roll some initiative, if only to keep track of who goes when and what they do. So to remind you how to do that, you click on your token. And you have an initiative button at the top, and it'll prompt you for...
Come on, crit fail.
Those are our agility dice. Is that
your agility? Yes, unless you have specifically trained in some type of, which I don't think anyone did, trained in an improved initiative, or have some type of benefit that would improve initiative. It would be under agility if you did, if it was a skill. So if everybody would do that, and then we'll sort it once we get all the details. We double check these guys' agility.
Sorry, I'm still getting used to this Roll 20 format.
Oh, shit. I had the wrong one. That's why.
Fail.
It's not my fault your system is broke.
What? Not. There we go. So yeah, you should click on your token. You should get a row of buttons across the top of the screen. 1d6, 2d6. Are you seeing those, Jessica?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's asking me number of dice to roll.
Right, which is your agility on your character sheet. No, that's fine. Page's agility.
It's one.
So for our viewers, again, we're playing a version of OpenD6 where we roll a dice pool. The pool of dice could be one die. It could be six die. It could be 12 die. But they're all D6s. They're all six-sided cubical die. And the attribute scores are based on that number of die. And sometimes you add a couple of pips, like a plus one or plus two. So, okay, I think I've got everybody in. Yeah. Those two guys go together. So let me sort this top down. Descending. So Aiken, looks like you're going to kind of get the opportunity to react first. Even though, I mean, you already did. I know you were moving in, people were moving in behind you. But at this point, you are poised to continue with your tripping action. It looks as though he may be aware of you now that Paige has moved up. Of course, her light source is shedding quite a bit of light, so... You think he sees you and he makes eye contact, but it doesn't look like he's going to stop.
Okay. I'm going to continue with what my plan was and attempt to just trip him up. I want him on his face in the dirt.
Yeah. Now, you all three have a bandana, if you will, around your right upper arm. It's kind of a bluish color, and it is the only indication that you have been recruited by the Night Watch. It's nothing fancy. It's nothing at all. Doesn't even have an insignia or anything that you can see, because it's wrapped and tied around your arm. But and
that is security in this town.
Yeah,
wrap it around your neck, you could be Fred.
Apparently, they ran out of the normal things that they would do. They've brought on quite a few people for this festival weekend, and you just got this blue cloth wrap to indicate that you are
some kind of rag that was laying in the closet somewhere.
Yeah, they ripped down the curtains and you know cut them into pieces and. and somebody's wife will find out about it later. But so, okay, your plan is to take one single action and just simply basically move in his way and try to you really want to trip him, or just are you going to jump in front of him and stop him, or are you seriously sticking the stick out and hoping to make him go face first into the dirt?
No, I don't want to be tangled up with him. I'm gonna trip him as I run past him. I want to be ready for these other guys coming up too.
Gotcha. Okay, so run past him and trip him. So it's a single action. The tripping action is going to be, the movement is a free action. So yeah. So you'll get to move first. You'll move somewhere like maybe like right there, and then reach behind you to trip him as he comes by.
Yep.
Okay, we'll deal with the tripping in a second because he has to go to make that happen. Ruin, you here? Are you able to see any of this yet? Are you within Paige's light source range?
I see the one dude right outside of her main light range.
Oh, good, because you can see where the action is. Good. And then you can obviously see Paige and Aiken then. So then you are capable of reacting however you see fit. But you also are the one that hears the other guys right on his heels.
Yeah, I'm going to be drawing my daggers and kind of waiting out of the light as much as possible. Use her light to kind of shine it on them.
Gotcha. Do you want to move at all, or you want to just stay where you're at, or are you?
I probably would just, depending on the light source, I might back up a little bit, but I would just be aiming, waiting for them to come into the light a little bit.
So would you move here? Or, because there's a tree trunk in your way. It's pretty much there, or back over to the left? Somewhere.
Yeah, just a little bit further back. Like is that black like line what I can see, or what the hell is that shadow thing that's on the screen?
Well, the black line is what you can't see because you're being blocked. You should.
Okay.
Yeah, you're probably in shadow right now because her light source is opposite. You're standing in a black shadow in a dark.
Okay, that works perfectly then.
Yeah. That makes sense? Yep. Good. All right. So you hear these guys move forward, and they are going to peer into the light. As they start closing on this guy, they are moving faster than he is, certainly. And they are almost on his heels here. And they see the other group, they obviously see the rest of you, and stop dead in their tracks. And one guy, the guy on the top, looks to the guy on the back and says, "You stay with Narsif. I'll deal with this. He can't get away." And the guy says, "Okay." And he lunges at Narsif, blades drawn. He just jumps headlong like he's trying to take him down, and he doesn't care if he cuts him. If he does, or he's going to take him out. So let me find his character sheet right here. And he's going to just lunge attack with his sword. It's a short sword.
Oh, I see.
And poor Narsif has no defense, really. He's got his back to him. He's just running. He's passively trying to get away. So that's going to hit Narsif, and he's going to take a wound.
Come on, man. The town drunk can't die that quickly.
Yep. He just did.
Oops.
No, he didn't die. He just took a wound.
We suck at our jobs, guys.
So you should see his wound indicator there.
Hey, I watched everything.
I'm watching the night go by.
Taking notes. You know. Don't know what happened.
File a report in the morning. You're just a professional witness is what you are, yeah.
I'm the night watch. I don't get paid enough to do anything else.
I'm not the night fight or the night attacker. All right, so the other one, as he run up to this point, he stopped and he squares off towards Aiken as if he's going to engage the ranger, so, or whatever Aiken is, Aiken. So Narsif does take his extra step. He obviously gets stabbed in the back. He's going by. The quarterstaff catches him. Go ahead and make your quarterstaff attack roll as you would if you were trying to hurt him.
Okay, so that's my might plus the quarterstaff, or is that already added for me on the sheet?
If you look at your character sheet,
three. Okay, I got it. Yeah.
Down at the bottom next to the staff is probably the best place. You'll see your attack and damages right side by side.
Yeah.
So cool. You can easily calculate them. You're at point blank range, but at the same time, you are making a targeted attack. So there's not going to be, I mean, I'm basically adding five and taking away five at the same time. So on this end, you crit failed. You rolled a one. So that is now a.
Told you, man, this wild die, man.
That is a five. So you do have character points. I don't know that I would spend them this early in sort of this, but you have, you should have five character points and one fate point.
Nope. You,
what are we going to do? Are we just going to fail?
Yep.
Yep. That's the plan, Matt?
Yep.
Okay. So
getting stabbed threw you off.
In this particular case, the only real suffer thing is the timing. As these guys came out and the guy stabbed in the back, you felt, caught yourself a little distracted by, ooh, action, yay, wait, what? And you stab and to stop him, and you just time it wrong, and he gets past you, and you fail. It's just that much. No critical. I mean, you just kind of stabbed the dirt, sure. You got the end of your staff dirty. But other than that, no other major side effects at this point.
Just yell, you shall not pass.
And I'm assuming that was the only action you were taking this turn, correct? I should have asked you. But...
That's the only thing I said. So yeah, we'll go with that.
Go with that. All right. So, and then finally, Paige, it's your turn.
All right. Well, so I saw all this happen, right?
Oh yeah. You're seeing, if it's in your, if you can see it in your light, you can see it.
All right. Well, I'm going to move up. Should I move my piece?
Just tell, yeah, where, yeah, you, as long as you're moving within the light range, you're fine.
Yeah, I'll move up to about maybe here.
I see nothing.
Sorry. Is that cool?
I don't see it. I hadn't moved on my end. There it goes. Yeah. Oh, yeah. You move in into the front of this guy. Oh, ruin, you're in the light.
And I'm going to say, hey. So what seems to be the problem here?
I was going to say, hey, that's it? Wow. Hey. Are you trying to sound, hey?
No, I mean, just like, hey, what are you doing? You know, like, with as much authority as I could muster, I guess.
Don't know Paige that well yet, but that sounds funny.
By this time
funny.
Of night, I'm usually about half drunk, so, like, it's probably pretty laughable. But
oh, has Paige been hitting the bottle while she was on guard duty?
I mean... That probably. Sort of goes with that saying.
She was blessing the freaking rocks at the river.
So your intention is just basically step in front of him and ask him what he's doing, nothing else.
Yeah, and I'm going to, you know, prepare to make my fire get a little bit bigger or something if I need to, but I just want to see what he's going to say.
It does, yeah. Gotcha. Ready yourself. Okay. Well, his, again, conversation, as long as it's not anything extravagant, is pretty much a free action. So it won't cost you anything. The movement doesn't really cost you anything. You barely moved. So, but you, you make your, you spend your time preparing yourself to be intimidating. Are you trained in intimidation? I mean, anybody can roll it, obviously, but if not, it's just base charm. You are?
Yeah, it's on my charm list, right? So that's
But you didn't take any points in it. But that's fine. Yeah, so you just roll in basically. Okay. You're not really trained.
Roll my 2d6.
Just 2d6, that's it. And since you're not taking any extractions or no penalties or anything. So
there we go. Hey.
Oh, and that exploded. So the opposite of rolling a one, guys, is rolling a six, and then you get to roll an extra die. Which was only a two, but still, it helped, right?
It did.
So, are you happy with that role in your attempt to intimidate this guy?
That seems like about as intimidating as I can get.
That's as good as it's going to be. All right. Well, let's see if he's influenced by your intimidation. He is. Look at there. That six helped. He got one, but on the second roll, and that's not good enough. So, it's not a huge success by any stretch of the imagination, but he seems to be caught off guard. And how is Paige dressed? I mean, does she usually wear low cut necklines? And I think you described her as being pretty
I mean, it's getting late, so she's probably, you know, she's had a couple drinks. She's getting a little flushed. She might have unbuttoned a couple buttons.
He's getting hot in here.
So, I picture as a rather voluptuous, curvy woman, as you said.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
So he's distracted, probably more by something like that.
Damn, look at those.
It wasn't really the kind of reaction I think you were going for. It wasn't the authority. But it was the authority. You
know? So she'll take what she can get, you know.
It worked. So he stops long enough to his scowl turns into a hey, wait. And then he realizes that this is probably not good. Get out of the way, woman. I have business here. Get away. Go away. And he looks like he's moving to move around you. But he's not gonna stab you. You don't have a weapon drawn. So at least he doesn't look like it. Okay, so back to the top. And I didn't even advance the turn order. I just left it there. But okay, Aiken.
Okay.
How do you react to your utter failure?
Annoyingly. annoyed. Yeah. So I can moving doesn't count as an action, right?
It depends on how far you move. So a short movement, in your case, all three of you can move about 15 feet. You don't have to use the grid. There's a faint grid there, so you don't have to be exactly in the squares. It helps. But to give you a sense of how far you can go, you would you move any more than about three squares or 15 feet, then it cause an action. I'd rather you focus kind of on what you want to do, and then I'll let you know. And if you're like, no, I want to back that up and change it because it's going to be too many actions, we'll do that.
Okay. So I want to back up to, like, about here.
I'll give that to you free.
Okay. And then I want to, because I failed the first time, I want to throw my staff in between his legs and try to trip him up again. And then I want to draw my bow.
So you ran up, made a hard right turn after you blew it. And you're going to run parallel to him and try to trip him with the staff.
Yeah, I'm
throwing
it. I'm going
to
throw my staff in between his legs so that his ankles get caught on it and then draw my bow.
All right. Well, drawing the bow doesn't necessarily have to be a separate action.
Is that not taking action? Oh, okay, cool.
It doesn't have to be, but it will make the roll you need to make to successfully hit him a little bit harder. So it's probably, it works about both ways. So your target, because you're trying to quick draw, your target action, the action you do with it, like if you say I draw an attack all at one time, it's just a higher roll. So usually add a couple points to the difficulty class, which is almost equivalent to minusing a die. But anyway.
I want to talk to Narsif, but I'm pretty sure these other two are going to try to kill us, so I'm going to go ahead and do that.
All right, so, you don't want to say something to him now. You're trying to stop him so you can talk to him.
Yeah, I'm not going to say anything to him yet. Yeah.
Gotcha.
I just want to trip him.
All right, so it's all one action, so we don't have to wait for turns. You can go now. Go ahead and make your throw roll with your staff. It'll be the same as attacking with it.
Just a regular attack roll? Okay.
Regular attack roll, yeah.
Nice.
Very nice. Are you happy with that roll?
Yes, definitely.
You double whammied on the wild die, exploded twice. Yeah. So very good. Okay. So, again, he's focusing on pretty much nothing but balancing and running. You do get the impression he's been drinking. He doesn't have a bottle in his hand anymore. But he's been stumbling a little bit, and you clearly successfully get that staff right where you wanted it to, perfectly executed. It's when on his turn, of course, he'll topple, but you can tell it's on target. And at the same time, you almost do it in one action and draw your bow at the second same action. It's just smooth. Very nice. All right, so Mr. Ruin,
chucking a dagger at the not intimidated dude.
Dagger in the back. Damn. Right. Awesome.
So you spend a turn watching. I'm gonna give you some bonuses here because you should probably say I'm aiming, I'm preparing, you know, I'm kind of taking my
time. That's what I was doing.
But my assumption is that is the plan and that you were taking your time to wait for the perfect opportunity. And for every turn you spend a full turn doing that, you get an extra die on your attack for like a ranged attack or a planned attack. So I'm going to give you an extra die on this attack. The range, are you within?
Should be.
Yeah, I'm sure you are. I think minimum is 30 feet or something. No, anyway, even if it isn't, it's fine. You're like 15, 20 feet away. Pardon me. Won't be any modifiers there. Are you going to do anything else other than throw this dagger this turn?
Nope. Trying to stab him.
You're just going to throw one?
Yes.
At this guy right here.
It would only remove... Where's the other guy? Is that the like brownish thing that's next to that guy?
Yeah, at this point you might want to zoom in to your. You can see a little bit better if you zoom out.
Looks like a pile of rocks.
He's not a pile. It's a top-down view of his head. It's both of them.
It's like your drawing skills suck. No.
Well, good thing I'm a game master, not an artiste.
That's what you get for failing my wild die. If I was to go for both of them, I would just lose one die, right?
One die on both rolls. So you'd be at your normal. And you only get the plus one die on the first one anyway. So one of them would be at normal. The other one would be at negative one die. And everybody gets to go before you throw the second one.
Yeah, I'll stick to just one right now.
All right.
See if I can take out the guy in the black.
Good.
Here we go.
Whoa, are you happy with that roll?
Yes, I'm fine with that.
You like that roll, huh? All right, so he is passively defending. He's not doing any type of active defense. So his defense was 10. That means you beat him by 13, if I'm not mistaken. Yep, so that's a huge success. Go ahead and roll your damage, please. Wow. 13 points of damage. On the wound chart. Oh, and for those who are watching, I'll throw a little tidbit your way. For those who aren't familiar with how this works. Oh, did it come up? It's not up here. Or maybe I won't show you what I'm trying to show you. There's a chart that shows what wound levels are, and for some reason, I can't get it to appear on the recording screen. So we'll do that later. Moving right along. Gotta love technical difficulties. So a wound of 13 or better is considered, and it was a 13, right?
Yeah.
I need to situate. Is considered a mortal wound. So not only is he instantly knocked unconscious, he is bleeding out.
OKO and dying.
Automatically knocked out and in the process of dying. So he is bleeding out. Let me put the bleeding heart on him there. Okay, so I bet you will. So very nicely done. Bravo. Good throw. You hit him like right square in the wherever. You want to describe it?
Back of the head probably.
What's that?
Back of the head or neck or something like that.
Back of the head.
Probably where neck. I would be aiming.
Yeah, neck sounds good. Yeah. So you got him like through the back of the neck and he's blood spurting and he goes down. He's totally stunned and knocked out. And yeah, he's not going to make it very long. So, but there he is. He's down and he is prone at the moment as a result, obviously. I should put that on there as well. So it was his turn next, technically, he and his friend. Unfortunately, his friend did not notice him fall forward and should have heard the thunk of the blade, but he didn't. And it came out of darkness anyway, right? So he keeps going. He's going after the ranger. And he's going to move and attack. His move, I'm not going to count against him, but he is going to try and take two swipes at our good friend, the ranger. So let me make note of the fact that he is going to take two actions before I forget. Where is our attack? Let's see, leather, sword, swords, maces. Sword and mace attack, 4D. So let me make this roll real quick, and that sound means we need to take a quick break. So I don't know if you can even hear it. Yes. Here it comes. And I shouldn't have rolled that in front of you because I need to ask you if you, oh, you went first. You know, never mind. You didn't have, so you're just passively defending.
I wasn't defending. So that
you weren't defending.
Me.
So it hits you. So, and his damage on. Should have had this more handy. So, all right. We're going to take a quick break and I'll come back. I'll roll the damage and we will pick up from there. And so as we're playing, you're going to hear us talking about making dice rolls. The players are going to roll dice, and to familiarize you more, if you're not familiar with how the dice work in Open D6 specifically, this chart will help explain some of the things that are going on behind the scenes. First off, they're going to roll a pool of dice. The pool could be, you know, just a single die. It could be up to 10 dice. They're all D6, six-sided cubical dice, numbered 1 through 6. So they're just standard dice like you have found in board games for decades. But the point is, the better they are at something, the more of them they have to roll. And occasionally they can add pips. So they might roll 3 dice and add +2 to whatever the result of those 3 all added together is. What they're trying to do is get, of course, the highest number possible. And the difficulty range here on the top left of the screen is an indication of what they're trying to roll. So if what they're trying to accomplish is very easy, they're only looking for like a number between 2 to 5. But if it's something rather difficult, it would be, you know, a number between 16 and 20. I'm pretty much the only one that knows what that target number is going to be. There are a lot of factors involved. It could be range. It could be how complicated a spell is. It just depends on what they're trying to accomplish. You also hear us talking about wild dice. Whenever they roll dice, if we were sitting around a table and we had a pool of, let's say they were rolling 6 dice, one of them would be a different color or a different size than all the others, and it would stand out, and that would be the wild die. So let's say they're rolling 6 dice that have 1 blue and the rest would be red. If that wild die is a 6, it explodes, is kind of the gaming term for what happens. And that means they get to get another wild die. So now they're rolling a 7th die. And this is a wild die as well. So if they roll a 6 again, it explodes. So that's what in the bottom left here of the screen, you can see that being explained. So every time they do that, the die explodes. And that's how we kind of account for the crazy randomness of the world. Things that happen, a gust of wind that, you know, blows an arrow off target or something. Speaking of which, if they roll a 1 on that very first attempt, that very first wild die, and whatever the set is, if it's a 1, and there's about a 16 to 17% chance that'll happen every time, then that's considered a failure, a critical failure. So not only do they lose the 1, but whatever the highest die is in the rest, they lose it as well. You calculate and add up what's left. And then on the right are wound levels. So as people get hurt, they're going to take wounds. The difference between how much damage someone does, and that's rolled, and how much damage the enemy can soak up is between 0 and 3, they're stunned. If it's between 4 and 8, they take a wound. And once it gets up to, you know, 13 to 15, that's a mortal wound. You'll see some specifics on when they're knocked out, when they're not, when they're dying, and therefore, you know, subject to bleeding out. Of course, 16 or above, they're dead on the spot. So finally, on the far right of the column, you'll hear as people are trying to heal each other and correct those wounds levels, they have a fixed target number they have to hit, providing there's no other extenuating circumstances, such as, you know, poison or something like that. So that's what's going on. There's one point during the recording, you'll see I tried to get that chart up on the screen. It wouldn't work, so I inserted it here. We'll get back to the game. All right, folks, real quick, quick correction I need to make. So the attack that Ruin made with the dagger out of darkness, I forgot to give the gentleman the benefit of his soak value. He's wearing underneath his cloak some leather armor, so he has the benefit of soaking some damage. He soaked 9 of those 13 points, which leaves 4. That's right, right? Yeah. And which is considered a minor wound, if you will, or a single wound, wound level 1, of which you can take, you know, 3. And that's where we had originally put him at wound level 3. Or actually, we put him above that. We had him at mortal wounded. So, but anyway, the point is, he's wounded, but he is no longer mortally wounded. And then now I need to roll damage for the attack this guy made on our fearless ranger. I think that was next. Yep. And zero. Ooh.
Ow.
That's pretty high.
And I roll my soak for my leather armor. Is that correct?
Correct. Yeah, your soak value. So this is going to hurt.
Oh, making me use stuff.
Maybe. Oh, man, that did
hurt.
Wow.
Yeah.
On you, crit. All right. So you can spend up to 2 character points. And this is where I shouldn't have rolled first. This is a great example. I should not have rolled. I got to stop doing that. You can certainly roll an additional character point, spin a character point to try and increase that soak if you'd like to.
Yeah, because that's still 14, right? Yeah.
So yeah, you should know that, but yes.
Yeah. Okay. So do I knock that down to 4, or do you do that for us?
I guess either one of us can. Yeah. Doesn't matter. Yeah.
Cool. And it's just one die, or
you just get one wild die. Yeah. So just hit the 1D button at the top left. It'll automatically be a wild die, and it'll roll itself again if you're so lucky.
Well, I'm not the wizard this time.
Neither is he. Two, right? Say that again.
No, I better. You said I could spend 2, right?
You can spend a maximum of 2. Some game masters let you spend up to 4 to keep from dying, but no.
That's still a mortal wound, so. Oh, goddamn. All right.
So what are we at now? 4, 3, 4, 5, 9. So you're taking a 10, is that right?
Is that 10? So hold on, how much do I have 9 total? Yeah, I guess so. I'm taking 10. Jeez, apparently.
So, and I think 10 is a wound level 2.
That's a 3.
Oh, it's a 3. All right, so now you must make a stamina saving throw, or might, if you don't have any training in stamina or anything like that, or endurance. Do you have any training in anything under might that might help you here?
I have willpower.
Under might.
No,
I will myself to stay awake. Okay, well then make a might check, and let's see if you can avoid passing out. Unfortunately, that's a no. So, all right. Well, it's been a short game, guys. It's been fun. Signing off right now. So our ranger goes down. He's not mortally wounded.
I think I'm just going to go ahead and maybe take my fate point and stay alive.
Well, and you have to do that before you roll.
You got to do that before you roll. Okay,
fate points have to be declared before you roll.
Before you roll. Okay. Right. All right.
Not to say someone else couldn't throw you their fate point. Or, you know. But I will allow you a stamina check on each round subsequent to regain consciousness, of course. So.
Okay.
You won't get the wound level reduced without some type of magical aid or healing or something like that. But you can certainly try to wake up. Fair okay. enough?
Yep.
Well, so that was a horrible turn. Good job. Ruin, you're up. Right. Of course, you probably can't see that at all. I can't see your... I obviously see the largest scale when it comes to the light source, so I see much farther.
That was on his turn. It's the...
Oh, did I not advance this thing? You're right. I didn't advance it. Doggone it.
It's the next... yeah.
So, yeah, this guy trips. Oh, yeah, he's going to stumble, obviously. So he's gonna land in this square on his face in the dirt, and he's... It's not going to take any damage from your attempt to stop him because you didn't want to do any damage. But, you know, as you're throwing it, this guy stabs you in the side, knocks you out. So he is prone on the ground. And we'll use that indicator to remind me so I don't forget. Now what, sir? Or it's his turn. Paige, excuse me, ma'am.
Okay, well, this guy here, he didn't listen to me. He's not answering my questions. So I'm going to take my torch and I'm going to hold it in front of me And then with my other hand, I'm going to make some arcane symbols, and there's just going to be this, you know, the fire of the torch is going to get bigger and bigger, and then it's just going to fly right at him.
Gotcha. So your intent is to envelop him in the flame using your torch and just and just kind of, you know, creating a burst of flame from him. Hey, he's right next to you. Hey, there's no range modifiers here. There's no reason why you couldn't do that. Matter of fact, you're going to be, because your point blank range, you're going to get a plus +5. I can't see any reason why you weren't. Are you doing anything else this turn?
No.
Okay. Well, then you get to roll that at full power plus a plus extra 5 pips.
Where did my
again? Just click on your. What's that?
Okay, click on your character token.
Yeah, you have to have it. You have it selected. So just click on it one time, and the little button should pop up at the top. Are they not?
No, for some reason it's not.
So click away.
Okay. Yeah. I got it. Sorry. Here.
So she didn't try to save Aiken. There was no cure blight wounds going on or anything like that. Just saying. I was
never really that good at healing spells. So it looks like I got an 18.
Are you happy with that roll?
Sure, that's fine.
All right. So yeah, it's physical damage. He's not going to defend that. So normally you would roll damage, but the damage is going to be the difference between what you rolled and his passive defense, which is 10. So your damage is going to be 8. He will soak, I think, 9. He soaks it up. So, you know, it didn't, wasn't as big and as impressive as you wanted it to be. You know, that one in there didn't help at all. So, you know, it certainly, you know, his clothing is smoldering and all that kind of stuff, but it looks like it didn't really do him any damage. Just a matter of scorching his clothing at this point. Again, he seems distracted, and you certainly got his attention, but it didn't hurt him. Okay. All right. So now it's a concern, right? Correct.
So what do I do? Just roll stamina?
Yep, do the same stamina roll. Your target is a 15, if I'm not mistaken. Yes. Well, I would ask if you're happy with that roll. I know you're not. But how unhappy with it? All those nasty ones.
Yeah. Gosh. I'm running out of character points pretty quick here. I got to roll a 5. So yeah. What happens if it's less than a 15?
You're just still unconscious.
So
you're not mortally wounded. You're not dying. You're not bleeding out. You're just knocked
nothing
out.
Nothing worse. Nothing worse happens.
You're laying on the ground unconscious, you know, other than that.
All right. I will, with only three die, it's pretty unlikely that I'll hit 15.
Okay, your average is like 11.
Screw it. Ah, screw it. Let's see. Maybe I can get 6. Try one more time. there we go. I got a 6. All right.
And it was a wild die, so it exploded. It was an 8. So you were 18. Yeah. So you regain consciousness with your 18 total. You are prone, but you are awake. So, and standing up is not a complete action, but it does have penalties against the next action because you're trying to, you know, do more than one thing at one time, unless you crawl.
Okay.
Okay. So you managed to wake up. Good job.
Yay.
Just cost you another character point, that's all. All right. Did you want to do anything else on your turn?
Yeah, no.
All right, Ruin, out of darkness.
Just curling into a ball, right, a free action.
I can see.
You can see whatever you can see. As long
brighter,
as...
But then there's the wider circle at the end where Aiken and the other guy are.
Yeah, if you can see... a faint glow around, you know, outside your normal vision, it starts fading and dissipating. But if you can see it on the screen, I'll give it to you. You can see it on
so
your
what
screen.
What I'm going to have to do is, damn thing, people dying already. The plan is to use my advantage.
Oh.
And kind of haul an ass over there and dropping the dagger, pulling out Shy.
Your twice a day ability to focus that one. And I'm looking, and I'm like, why is it? I'm looking at the wrong character sheet. Let's see. Your selective empowerment.
Fire, however the hell you want
to. Say that again.
A fun stunty. I'm not sure like how the timeline goes like between the turns and stuff. Like underneath the fire, through the fire, or.
No, you're not in any danger of getting in the fire at the moment.
So yeah, I would just be using that and hightailing it over directly at that guy.
See if this works. So you're going to run over behind him and
for a full-on charge and attack.
Full-on charge, pounce. Oh, I got to get off that button.
Like, try to cleave him with an anvil.
So do I can jump in the air, cut him in half, kind of things like that?
Something like that.
Well, the movement's not far enough to cost us an action. The attack obviously will be an action, but because you've empowered yourself, you're going to get an extra 2D on that. Plus, I'll give you an extra plus one pip for the charge. And so you add 2D plus one to whatever you normally would roll. And then we'll see how well you do before you describe it.
Is it the guy in black or is it the other guy?
Oh, I thought you were charging this one. That's in black. They're both in black, really, but.
Oh, the brown. Yeah.
Oh, you're trying to run way over there to that guy that's in front of Aiken.
That was why triggering it, because it's reaction based.
I understand now. I understand now. All right, so in that case, you were over here somewhere. We're talking 40 feet. Yeah, you're really hauling. So. Yeah, you will have to do this in two actions. Your first action will be the run maneuver, and then your second action will be to actually attack him. So everybody will get to go real quick before you take the second action.
Like between it?
Like huh?
From the empowerment? One for the adrenaline.
Your intention of using the empowerment was to move faster, in other words?
Yeah. To kind of...
It's going to work out the same in the end, anyway.
My stamina that's already trained and use it to get there quicker and, you know, whatever. Do as much damage as possible.
Yeah, we can do 1D instead of 2 if you want to not be penalized that way. That's fine.
Yeah, I was thinking about separating it into, you know, 1D for the run.
Gotcha. Hey, sounds cool to me. I like it. It's all about the story, so go for it. How happy are you with that?
I'm happy with it. It's just a run right now.
Yep. Well, he had a second action on hold, which I never used.
I didn't add the extra die to the run.
1, 2, 3. You did 4D plus 1?
No, I did 3. Oh, yeah, it was
4D. Yeah, you rolled 4D. Yeah. It's separate in the calculation with the exclamation point, so it knows that the first one's a special. So you good with the 17 then?
Yes.
All right, he's going to try and act. So he, and what does that sound like? The adrenaline rush, was it? Are you screaming, yelling, barbarically? What do we see?
I would be quiet.
It's quiet. There's a tiptoe run.
It's just literally dropping the dagger, pulling out the other weapon, and just heading straight for it, like tunnel vision.
Gotcha. It looks like wire work. You go.
Yeah. Something like that. Dodging around the other guy and just. No. Then probably leaping of some sort. I don't know if that's necessary. However, we want to make it look.
Hey man, enjoy.
I don't have Nando's creativity when it comes, and there's no flying creatures for me to jump on.
Gotcha. So these guys have static defenses as opposed to rolling them, and his defense is going to be a 9 to kind of dodge and try to step out of the way of your attack at the last second, which of course fails. So you certainly beat him significantly. Having said so, roll your damage, please. And
well, that was just the run for the athletics part of it, because that was over the 30 feet.
Oh, because you're – oh, well, I didn't penalize you for that, because you were using
the extra 1D. Yeah, that's why I used the extra
1D. To make that better? Okay. Yeah. All that does is say how far of extra you can go over above 30 feet. So it's not an attempt to do it well. It's an attempt to see how far you can go above the 30. Okay. Which was quite a lot. You were hauling ass. So you could have gone 47 feet in your one action to increase your distance over 30. Had you rolled a one, however, you would have tripped. So yeah, okay, fine. If you want to, then roll the attack separately then. Okay.
And that is... Oh, that's a fun one.
That's a fun one? Oh, because you...
Oh, wait. Damn it, I forgot the pip. Add a 1 to that.
We'll just add 1. It's 25. Ouch. Roll damage. Okay.
That is also... All right.
And he soaks 9 of that. So he takes a wound. These guys are faring better than I thought they would. Oh, did I put that on the... Oh, he can't see it. Fix that. See it. All right. No, you still can't see it. Oh, I know what I did wrong. Technicalities. 1 of 3. There it is. All right, so you manage to rush over there and land a solid blow. Again, the armor absorbs quite a bit of it, but you do manage to wound him. And I think that was the only thing you were doing, correct? Right. So recently scorched guy has turned his attention on the mage and says, "You want to burn me? I'll show you what happens to people who burn me." And he raises his blade. Aiken was top of the defense. So you haven't gone this turn yet. You do get a chance now to decide, Paige, if you want to defend, if you're going to defend yourself this turn, or you're just going to use your passive defense, which is a 10. So if he rolls anything higher. Having said that, if you do anything, you have to tell me now if you're going to do anything other than defend yourself, and then you'll, of course, have a penalty
for doing more than one action. I was planning to – I mean, I think if I saw the blades coming, I think I would probably try to just defend myself.
All right. Your attempted way of defending yourself, I think the only thing you have in your hand is a torch. So you normally have a quarterstaff, I don't recall, let's see, or anything like that. You haven't mentioned having any weapons.
I have an extra normal shield power. Can I attempt that?
You want to defend yourself. Now, the only way to the extra normal power to defend yourself would be a precursor to being attacked.
Okay.
So the way you defend yourself reflexively is dodging, parrying with an item in your hand or something like that.
Now, having torch to the face.
You know, if it's a significantly big enough roll, you roll somewhere in the 30s, we might call it a super win there.
It takes the walnuts.
Three back-to-back sixes in the wild die, and we might say, oh, wait a minute, this turned around the other way. But it's up to you.
I guess I will attempt to dodge.
Dodge, okay. And are you going to do anything else this turn? Are you going to take your entire turn to just dodge the blow?
I will take my entire turn to dodge the blow.
Okay, well then you roll it full with no penalties. Which is exactly what you've got if you hadn't rolled, which is a 10, is your passive roll anyway. So,
you get your 10 on top of that?
You get a plus 10, that's right. So you have technically rolled a 20. I forgot the full.
I was gonna say we're all gonna die. What's the point of this game, Paul?
I was pissed at you guys, and I finally get to take it out on you. It's been so long. I'm going to kill another player.
I think you're going to do that.
Nah. Okay, so you successfully roll a 20. Are you happy with that roll?
Yeah, I think that's about as good as I can expect.
Yep. All right, let's see if it's good enough. If this guy just totally crits everything.
Fail.
Phew. No, but he rolled good. They're all three and above. But he misses. You barely dodge out of the way at the last split second. You zig and you fake him out. But it was close. That was a close call. All right. The other gentleman gets to go, and he's now getting stabbed in the back. He's got a ranger down. So he's going to turn his attention away from the ranger and turn around on this
down,
guy.
Down a die, right?
He is down a die because of his wound, correct. And,
Aiken's
down three. No. Their enemy soak is static as opposed to rolled. So.
Right.
Yeah, it's a, you basically assume they get a three. So if they have a 3D in soak, they rolled a three on every die. They can never wild die it. They just get a flat three per die. So, yeah, he's going to whip around and try to engage Ruin. And so he brings his sword around in a wide sweeping arc and only rolls three this time. Now, have you gone? You've already gone this turn, so you don't have an opportunity to defend.
Just my normal armors.
He hits you with a 13, so we need to roll his damage. Oh, and he rolled a. Yeah, he rolled a one. And I don't mean you take the one away, you take the three away, what's left over is a one. I'm not even going to give you a stun with that. Technically, he would win at least a stun for, hitting you, but you're not stunned. He totally bops it. He swings wide. You do one of those classical, matrix backwards bends, and he sloshes right past you. And you're right back up in his face. So that was a total fail. So our guy on the ground, our drunk, just starts trying to crawl away. he didn't even stand up. He just kind of crawls a few feet over back here, trying to get out of harm's way.
Just starting trouble, running away.
And
kill him later.
All right, Paige. Unfortunately, you spent your entire turn defending. So we're back to the top to Aiken.
All right. I'm going to go ahead and roll on the ground over here.
Roll on the ground.
Since I definitely don't want to stand up right next to the guy that just cut my gut open.
Understandable.
And I think I'm going to go ahead and use my... we never discussed specifically what I had in my healers, my enhanced healers kit. So how that...
In my opinion, it's a healer's kit like any other, but you've got some really expensive, really potent reagents. So it's got poultices and, things like you slap on. It's got, a potion or whatever. But as time goes on, we'll role play a little bit more of the things you find and put into it to get it back into circulation. But I think we decided on two. What rank is it?
I think it's a plus 2D to my regular heal check is what you said, I think. I don't know.
No, I think that's right, because I think it was two rank two, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, that's what I have on my sheet. So.
Okay, very good. And I think we decided you get two uses out of it as well before you've emptied it.
All right, so I'm going to go ahead and use that to heal myself.
Right. So you'll be making a heal check? And add the 2D to it.
Okay. Oh, my God.
Yay, it's not me this game. As much till this next roll.
What?
So Aiken is now the one. he is the one. And
it did win American Idol or something, so.
Wow. Now he will forever be. I mean, not only did you roll the one in the wild die, you rolled two more ones and nothing above three.
I'm telling you, that's one of the reasons why I can't play with this roll 20. It's evil.
Wow, I've never seen this before. All right, so 3, 4, 5, 6.
Come on, no, I swear all of Hunter's friends were rolling ones when they were playing.
So it's technically a 6 there, Matt.
Okay.
Not gonna.
That was pretty sorry.
Not gonna do
that. That's nothing, good. Right?
You're not gonna get anything out of a 6, but you know.
I miss those D20s, man.
Yeah, with a wound level 3, your target's like 20.
I rolled 66.
Yeah, you did. Wow. Two of them got taken away. And the rest of them were just horrible. Well, thanks for playing. We really appreciate it. We really did.
Yeah.
So, right. Listeners, we may be auditioning for a replacement player soon. Stay in touch. Watch the website. I take it that was the end of your turn.
Yeah.
Ruin, you're up, sir.
All right, so can you do an intimidation like while you're kind of swinging? Like
you can do anything. You can try anything.
Like,
is you
that
want,
two
sir.
Actions? Is I'm wondering.
No, typically not. Depends on what you're doing to intimidate. If it's are you talking about like a verbal intimidation?
No, tweaking my neck to the side, smiling kind of maniacally, and then bringing the sword down on him.
A silent expression.
Yeah, just smile, eyes brighten. Yeah, going to cut him down.
Wow. Okay. Well, sure. Go for it. Let's make an intimidation check. I'll give it to you as a free opportunity.
Hopefully it doesn't roll a 1.
Sounds like you're going to combine it with, and look there. See, he's rolling 6s there, Matt. What the hell? All right. What is his? Are you happy with that, sir?
Yes.
All right. And your intention is to just scare him.
Oh, make it easier for me to cut him.
Ah, I see. To reduce, I don't know. Intimidating somebody might increase their defenses, make them less likely to attack. Wow, that's a pretty damn good roll, but not good enough. So yeah, you seem to. His eyes get wide as you bring your weapon to bear, and you make your thwack. So,
okay.
Assuming you continue to, you want to continue with the attack. You're not gonna.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's good enough.
Good enough?
Yeah.
All right, that is a hit, obviously. Roll your damage.
Okay. Bless it. Crap.
Well, I'm going to give you. Oh, wait a minute. You lose to 5, 6. So that's a
6.
That is a 6.
Yes.
Are you happy with that?
No, but life's a bitch.
Okay. Well, since you did intimidate him, I will rule that he's technically stunned. If only because he's shocked by the look that you gave him. He's intimidated, what he is. He's not stunned, he's intimidated. Mm-hmm. So it may have similar effects as to being stunned. Let's put it that way.
Okay.
All right, sir. And that was the only thing you wanted to do us in this turn.
Yes.
You didn't give yourself any penalties for multiple actions. No. All right. It is their turn. Well, the guy in black's going to, of course, try to kill the mage again. He's getting really frustrated and doesn't like the fact that she tried to burn him. He is going before you again, Miss Mage. So are you going to actively defend? Or are you going to?
I'd like to take a step back from him if I could. I mean, I'm assuming that when I was dodging, did I move at all? Like, or did I just...
No, it's not really part of movement or anything. Having said so, movement is a free action. You can do that without counting against you. So if you'd like to assume you did that before, that's fine. He's basically going to close on you as his free action. So it's not going to make a lot of difference in the end, but...
I'll defend myself, but I want to use an action for my next...
So you're going to take two actions. The first action is going to be to defend yourself now. Gotcha. All right. Well, then go ahead and actively defend his incoming attack.
So I should just roll my regular.
Are you dodging again?
Yeah.
But and you're minus 1d.
Okay, so it's just going to be 1 then, because it's just 1d plus 1.
Okay. So the decision you're making is to make, you're basically hoping for a wild die because your defense is 10 if you don't do anything, if you don't defend yourself, if you just hope he misses, you're counting on him rolling less than a 10. You can do that, or you can actively defend and try to roll better than a 10. It's going to be hard to do with only one die.
No, I'll just passively defend then. Cause...
Okay. So he's going to take a swing at you then, and we'll see if he hits. He is minus 1D because he is wounded. So here we go. Damn. So he hits you. And now he's going to roll damage. And I cringe again. Oh, damn. Wow. Okay, so now you have the ability to soak up some of that damage. So yes. He has hit you. There's no doubt about that, but you have a defense capability here. It is not affected by how many actions you took or anything like that. It's you just roll the full, because it's a combination of your stamina and your armor and your amulet. Mm-hmm. So I think it's, let me find your character sheet. Leather and amulet 3D. So you get to roll 3D to, in defense of soaking up some of this damage. Don't roll any ones. So you only took 3, basically, points, if you will, of the 15, which is only enough to stun you. Okay. But that's, you know, still an effect. So you are stunned for the remainder of this round and the entire next round. Keep that in mind. Okay. That was his attack. So the other guy, he's stunned and intimidated. So he's let's see here. He's going to attack, but at the same time he's going to say, "Stop fighting us. We only want the drunk guy. He's not worth dying over." And he's going to, of course, lash out. But that's all he's going to do. So he tries to attack you there, Mr. Ruin. He rolls on a... I shouldn't have told you. Never mind. Too late. Well, you couldn't defend yourself anyway. You didn't save any actions to defend yourself. So
I just saved for my soak.
Yep. So you want to... He, of course, is going to hit you. Oh, crap. That's what I shouldn't have rolled yet, but that's okay. So, are you going to roll any character points to try and increase that?
That's a 1 wound or 2?
It's an 8. I think 4 to 8 is 1 wound.
Okay. Yeah, I'll just take the 1 wound.
Take the wound. All right. Whack. Saving those points. Cool. Well, at this point, nobody's done anything I think awesome, spectacular yet, but I'm going to give you all a character point at this point for suffering through this. I should give Matt an extra one for being horribly inefficient, but everybody give yourself a character point for just hanging in there.
That's your stupid program that you're making me play on. We're using physical dice. This wouldn't be happening.
Yeah, the probabilities would be totally different.
See, I get my ones up damage.
Exactly.
All right. So that's going to be their turn. And then it's going to be our drunk's turn. He's going to continue to saunter off into the bushes. He's finding a place behind the trees over here and just kind of hide behind the trunk of this tree and try to stay out of sight and mind. And then it'll be Paige the Mage's turn.
So because I'm stunned, I'll just be at a disadvantage to whatever I do. Is that correct? Or can I not take any action?
No, you can continue to take as many actions as you want, but you are automatically at a -1 penalty for this round and next round.
Well, first I'm going to ask him, like, why are you attacking that guy?
Okay.
Why? And I'm getting pretty pissed off at this point. I mean, he's swinging his swords at me. He's insulting me.
Yeah, that temper's kicking in, right?
Temper's kicking in. And I'm going to hold up my hand and focus all of my rage energy into a missile and aim it at his throat.
So why are you attacking this guy? Well, he'll respond because he can respond in kind in the same turn. It's kind of a free action. He goes, because he has something we need. It's none of your business. Of course, that just pisses you off more, right? So that uncontrollable rage kicks in, which in this case is not necessarily a negative. It's almost going to work in your favor, I think, because you're not going to put up with this too much. Okay, so you can make your attack. And it's the only thing you're doing this turn? Or are you going to save? Well, you're the last person to go. It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
So, okay. You're just going to be minus 1D on the roll because of the being a little dazed from the attack.
Okie dokie.
Too bad that 6 wasn't first, right? Now, it's got to get those blasted ones. So, okay. Well, he is passively defending. So it is a hit, but it's only 3 points of damage. And he's able to soak that. His armor is fighting your fire.
I don't like this guy, man.
It's okay. It'll get better. I'm trying to see if there's any advantages here yet that have come into play. I don't see anything that would be of help to anyone yet. So, Aiken.
All right,
Aiken. We're back with you, rolling around in the dirt there.
Well, I'm not rolling. I'm just lying on my back and looking up at the trees and trying to calm myself, you know, listening to the wind through the trees. And
focus.
The goddess of nature will smile upon me as I lay there. And so I'm going to first take a long pull from my water skin.
It doesn't have water in it.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm going to try to heal myself again.
with the water skin or with the healing pack?
No, with my healing pack. That was my movement. Was to take a long drink.
Right. Well, you give yourself another character point there, sir. That was great. I like that. All right. Now make your roll and let's see if we get to laugh again.
Spills the water on himself.
That's a bit nice. All right. So that dropped me down a wound level. Is that correct? Or
yeah, you get to reduce one wound level there. So
okay,
that took care of it for you. And there you go.
Okay.
So much better, sir.
Yes.
All right, Ruin. You see in the background, past your target, your peripheral vision. You know, you're used to taking in all the surroundings in a combat mode, especially. And you see him over there, praying to the sky and pouring wine on a wound and then licking it, and then you know,
fucking rangers.
Like, what the hell's going on over there?
All right, so I'm going to use the power again. So, question about the fate. We all get one, right? Mm-hmm.
You have one at present, yes.
And how does that work? Like,
you declare what you
damage or something, and does that let me re-roll if I get a 1, or does it re-let me, like, how does that work?
You declare that you want to use it before you roll. That's the first, primary, and biggest, most important part. And then you declare what you want to use it for. It can be used for a lot of different things, really. You can kind of change the storyline a little bit. You can adjust the settings. You can say, hey, I'd like to use my fate point to, you know, actually have that an extra wound come off of Aiken. You could, whatever. You don't have to be on yourself. It's nice if we can tie it to a story element. You know,
okay.
Kind of odd how you would do that from way over here. But you can also mechanically just use it to spend twice as many die as you normally would for any roll. So you double your die.
Okay.
So it can be a drastic heroic game changer, obviously, okay. If you use it that way.
Cool. Okay. So I will probably use it if I get the attack and on the damage.
On the damage. You want to do the damage, the attack normal and the damage you want to...
So aura and then fate on the damage. I'm going to split one die each. for the attack. So to basically counteract the one die lost from the wound.
Gotcha. Understood.
And then so, added die.
So when, does anything, do we see anything when all of a sudden you become empowered? I mean, is there a faint glow? Is there a
no, because it's all, like we had discussed, it's all natural ability, so.
Yeah, it's just like this.
I would say maybe his eyes glow brighter or something like that.
That sounds cool. I like it because that supernatural limitation that's holding you back, you suddenly get past it. So your eyes glow.
His eyes are pale blue, so they probably come a little bit brighter.
His little light, little lightning sparks.
Like really cool.
Yes, it starts glowing like Goku. It gets frosty tips. And he starts singing emo shit.
You're gonna sing when you
No.
No.
Okay. I was gonna say, Paula, you gotta make
he has to be quiet. But...
Like I gotta hear this. Good thing you backed that one out. But I do expect some gel in the hair next time and get the camera closer so we can all really
I am growing
appreciate.
It out slower slower. It just takes forever.
Yeah, you'll do it faster than I will, I promise you.
All right,
sir. So go for it. So
normal 4D6.
How happy are you with that?
I am happy if it hits him and he wasn't dodging or whatever.
I'm happy if it works, right?
Yeah.
But he hasn't got a chance to go yet, so he's going to try and actively dodge. Doesn't mean he's going to be successful at it. He's stunned still. Or he's intimidated, excuse me.
Yeah.
And his dodge is 9 statically, so that means it's a 3, but he's down 1. This is probably a bad move. And he rolls a 7. So you beat him. Now you may roll your damage and you may fate point if you wish and double it.
Okay. So yes.
Spend your one and only fate
points. So I just do the full number, I guess? Like I would have to roll this D6 thing at the end here.
Yeah, you're going to use the since there's not one. How many are you rolling?
It's going to be 10d6.
Yeah, so I put everything up through 9, so just go to the last one, and it'll prompt you for the number of dice. And then
it says number of exploding dice, 1, and then 9. Okay. And pips, no. No pips.
Nice.
But you did roll 2 ones. So 38 damage. You split him in half. Yeah.
That was the plan.
Yeah, yeah, he's kind of this nasty. Unless you, hey, describe it. You tell me what you want. I don't know.
If it cuts down through his shoulder,
yeah,
and through the torso, I'm going to rip it out to the side. So it's not just going straight down. It's like ripping him in 2 parts. Yeah. Kind of. I don't know, like chopping off his top half, quarter half or something
like sounds horrible.
Yeah, like going down from the chest and then splitting off like a angle.
How about this
pulling it out so I can spin it to almost turn around, start heading towards the other guy.
Yeah, you kind of get one leg up on this little bush over here, you know, and get a and you spin. So he does a spin and comes down, the momentum cuts down through him and of course at the same time you start
it's almost like a like an NBA guy like walking away from the shot like
yeah
after he hits it goes through him and then just kind of moves on
like it didn't even happen like
psh, yeah
and then you spin around which doesn't matter there's no facing on the tile so,
yes exactly
good all right so
3D world
nasty kill so those of you who've been drinking the Aiken and Paige like ooh Paige probably didn't notice that probably heard it. And he gave the enemy, the fallen hero or fallen victim or villain had sure made some type of sound. Got that. Aiken, you got to see it full, you know, you were looking over that way and ooh, it was vicious.
Awesome.
Yeah. So it's his turn. Oh, he's dead. So his counterpart, I'm going to make a roll to see how solid he's going to be dealing with that from a morale standpoint. His willpower. Okay. So, Ruin, why don't you, I'm going to give you a free intimidation check. Roll just, if you don't have a skill in intimidation, you just roll
oh, yeah, I do.
Charm. Oh, that's right. Got skill in just about everything.
Yep.
A little bit, anyway.
Would I use the aura in this part?
No.
Okay. Not the adaptive one, but...
No extra dice or anything, no.
Okay.
Yeah.
Not good.
Want to spend a character point or no? You weren't really actively doing it, just giving you an opportunity to see if you can beat his role.
No, if he runs, it's better for me.
Yeah, he's. Oh, technically, I take both dice roll. He rolled a zero.
Wow.
So yeah, he's not even going to run. He's going to drop to a knee and he's going to drop his weapon and he's going to go. Oh my God, give up, it's not worth all that, my gosh. And he drops the blade and he's like, just let me leave with my life, I'll be fine. Having said that, the drunk yells out, kill him, he tried to kill me. He'll try to kill me again. Don't let him live. And then of course, Paige, it's your turn.
Okay, so this dude's like on his knees, he's dropped his weapon.
He's dropped his weapon, he's dropped to his knees. And he's holding his hands up, begging for his life.
Well, approach him, and one of my hands becomes a hand of fire, and I reach out to, you know, to touch him. I'm going to attempt to interrogate him, see what's going on.
So, again, you still got the torch. You take the fire from the torch, and you just you direct it to burn him?
No, I... Some of the fire goes onto my hand, like it's like my hand's on fire.
Oh, come on. And then,
what?
Make his blood boil or something.
Stick your fist in his mouth.
Well, I was gonna grab him by the neck with my burning hand and ask him a few questions, you know, like
gotcha.
Get that skin burning.
All right. So okay. Well, let's mold to make sure the spell works. Make sure we don't fail the spell. You are minus 1D, though, keep in mind, because you are still stunned. But that comes off this turn. Okay. Well, it's actually a very effective technique, because you're not attacking, per se. You're intimidating is what you're doing, but you're using your flame to do it. So it's enough to get past... He doesn't have any armor, obviously, around his neck. You're just grabbing him, and he's not going to try and block or defend or do anything like that. You didn't miss his neck. So you managed to scorch him there, and he's definitely intimidated. He's burned. You've burned him slightly. And at the same time, what do you want to say? If assuming you wanted to say something while you had interrogated him.
I will say... All right, love, why don't you tell me the story of tonight and why you're out here?
All right. Fair enough. I'm going to turn the turn counter off because we are no longer in turn-by-turn combat, so we can get rid of that. So, yeah, you got the fire on his neck. You're burning him. We were hired to get a map from him. I don't got no map. He's crazy.
I look over my shoulder. Does one of you guys want to?
Yeah, jump in as you
secure
like.
Secure him.
I'm gonna stand up slowly and just kind of walk over here non-intimidating, kind
of
quietly, and then and offer him my my water skin.
Oh, okay.
Grab the drunk.
That has a distinct non-watery smell coming out of it.
No sooner than you get it towards him, he's like, oh, thank you. And he's just guzzling. Good, good, good. Anything you want to say to him as you're engaging him with spirits?
Not yet. I figure I know his nature pretty well, so I think I'm just gonna share the water skin for a few minutes with him and smile and nod and crazy night, huh? That kind of stuff.
You're plying him with spirits. Gotcha. Quite frankly. All right. How about you, Ruin? You just, what are you doing, if anything?
Is he talking? Like, is the guy spilling his beans?
Yeah, he's going to start talking. He's like, oh, he's, well, He said, "We heard what he said. He said, I was hired to get a map from him." "No, I don't have the map." "Yes, you do. You know you've got it. You talk about it to everybody how you got captured." That kind of dialogue is going back and forth.
All right, so I'm going to drag part of that dude's body over to that guy.
You're going to drag part of his body, like the severed chunk?
Top half, yeah.
Okay.
Top corner, half that's left.
Okay. You've got a shoulder cut there. You drag it over. That's kind of morbid, but that's Corona, everyone. Welcome.
Rune's pretty creepy.
Yeah. No, the Corona. I was talking about Raul. He's pretty creepy. But oh yeah, Rune.
No, Raul's creepy too. Yeah, I knew that. I didn't know about his character yet.
apparently they're very much alike. So he's
classic Raul.
Absolutely classic. Give yourself a character point there, Raul. gross. And he reacts accordingly. He cringes and is like,
Paige is like super into that.
And he's kind of looking at you longingly, like, what? You see this? Of course, he's in the meantime dealing with the burning. Please stop burning me.
Yeah, because you said these guys know me, so I'm not a nice person.
Well, you haven't been in enough situations where you've been able to actually do this before. Yeah, so this is the first time they see just how vicious your attacks can be under the right circumstances.
Yeah, this is going to be a fun one.
Yeah.
I'm glad Sid's not here.
Oh, he may be. We'll invite him in as a guest. Having said that, all right, what else is going on? Anyone?
All right, well, I'm going to ask him, who hired you?
I don't know his name. He didn't tell us his name. He just had a big bag of coins.
Where were you supposed to bring the map?
Back to the tavern.
What did he look like?
Are you still burning him?
Yeah.
Which is effective, but if you keep burning, if you stop burning me, I can talk more freely.
Keep insight, like just try to determine if he's lying or not talking.
Yeah.
Holding something back.
If you don't have the specific skill, then you can certainly. Okay. Well, then of course you do. I do.
Not much. Because I'm so knocked out.
You spread yourself so thin, yeah.
All right, well, I'm going to keep my hand on his neck. I'm gonna lower the flame on my hand, but I'm going to brandish the torch at his nuggets.
Oh.
Just in a threatening manner.
Well, yeah. As opposed to what? A playful manner?
Yeah.
What other manner is it?
I don't think fire in that area in any. There's no way for it. Yeah, there's no other.
Well, that's why the ranger was.
Yeah.
Holy shit.
That just is what it is.
We're learning a lot about a lot of characters today. You know, when she's entertaining her fellow folks, she sometimes has playful torch play.
It's on my resume.
What's the safe word? It burns. Holy cow. And there we've diminished it to, whoa, somewhere.
Yeah, Paige, she's got a lot of different skills.
So. Okay, yeah. Well, so she's got a hell of a skill there. So, yeah, she's hovering the flame in his crotch. And he keeps spilling the beans, obviously. Would you make your insight check? I missed it.
No, not yet.
Okay. Wow. Paige, give yourself a character point. Wow.
Meanwhile, I want to start like having kind of a sort of nonchalant whispered conversation with this drunk guy, you know, like, man, what the hell's up with these assholes? You know, kind of try to get him, like, why are they, you know, like, try to get him talking as we drink about about what happened tonight. Those kind of nothing, no direct questions. So I'm not asking about the map or anything like that.
Yeah, surreptitiously, yeah, prodding a little bit there. Okay, so yeah, no role is needed. He seems pretty pliable. As a matter of fact, he's at this point, he's passing the wineskin back and forth, kind of like, yeah. But then as you take it, he doesn't let you get much on it, and then he wants it back. You know,
but it's okay. I got two.
It's like, here, keep that one. I got this one. Man, you're my kind of guy. You totally saved me tonight. And they both have no water, right? Yeah. Would you like white wine or red wineskin? okay. So, he's just coming forth with, I'm sure you've heard my story. I got abducted and the cult, and they supposedly have heard that I have a map, which I don't. I mean, I know about where it was, but nobody's ever been interested before. Nobody's ever believed me. But they want to go to the cult because he heard they were protecting a fountain of like youth or something, or some kind of magical fountain, which I've told people that kind of stuff for a long time. That's why they abduct people and kill them for their god. And now he believes me, so he threatens me and wants a map. I don't have a map. Something along that line. It's kind of how he goes on. Meanwhile, with your check there, Corona, are you happy with that?
Yeah, it's
fine. Okay. So you get the sense that he's...
The end result's going to be the same.
Okay. Well, he seems to be holding something back. It's not so much that he's lying to you, but he's, you know, you don't get the sense that he's telling you the whole truth. Would you, really? I mean, would you tell the whole truth if you thought you might be able to cover it up? So it seems like he might be trying to cover something up. You could be wrong.
Like out in front of him or anything?
What's that? I can barely hear you.
Are his hands out in front of him?
Like, yeah, he's still doing this. Occasionally he reaches to his throat and kind of tries to, you know, brush the her away. But then when she moves the torch down, he's kind of like, he's more shifting his hips now and trying to keep, you know, without doing anything to piss her off.
It's going
to
be unpleasant, but,
yeah. Oh, really?
I'm going to chop one of his arms off, one of the hands off when he's up like that with his hands.
Holy smokes, bro!
And then I'll use my healing skill to stop the bleeding.
Okay. Well.
Jeez. not sure about this guy.
Let's make an attack roll just to make sure you don't totally blow it in the moment.
Some bastard of Bolton shit right there.
Like, next scene, he's tied to a wagon wheel and oh no. Holy smokes, dude. And this doesn't violate that code of rules that you have?
Oh, that's actually, yeah, this is the rules are for this kind of stuff.
Oh, great. Yeah, I definitely need to see this list of rules. Rule one.
What I did was, that was for the rules, was helping the other people.
Rule one, kill with panache. Yes. Rule two, maim with panache.
It's more of almost like a warrior mentality or soldier mentality, I guess, kind of. If you're not getting what you need, it's wasting time. Yeah, and I care not for
you're not being aggressive enough
dealing with people.
Yep. All right. Did you make the roll?
Yeah,
oh 17. Yeah. Okay. So with a quick slice, the blade barely comes past you there, Miss Torchbearer, and you out of nowhere caught off guard as he whops this guy's hand off. Of course, he reacts with it. He grabs the nub and he kind of collapses the ground all around. Oh my God! No, don't kill me! Okay, I'll tell you anything. And he's rolling around in pain, anguish, and he's now much more wounded, obviously. He's missing a hand.
All right, and is he rolling around on the ground?
Oh, yeah.
Back or on his stomach or what?
Kind of all of the back, not on his stomach. It's more of a on his back and holding because he wants to keep an eye on you guys. He's watching you intently.
All right. Oh, yeah, I'm going to be an asshole.
Oh, my God.
Unpleasant. I'm going to put my foot on his chest and tell him to stop.
That's what I was going to do.
So you both at the same time.
Yes.
And then we look at each other and we're like, ah, jinx, you know.
Really?
I like you. And then I'll use the master healing to kind of not save the arm necessarily, but cauterize the wound.
Gotcha. Well, fair enough that you will be able to prevent him with, and I'm not going to require a roll for it. I mean, you'll heal him to the point that he is not bleeding out and he's not passing out. He's still obviously very, very, very severely wounded. He's missing a hand. So he's much diminished in his skill set. Having said that, the healing doesn't take away the phantom pain.
No. That's the whole point.
Yeah.
As much torture as possible.
Of course.
Both mental and physical.
Wow.
And I'm going to say to him, well, before my companion chops you to bits and the last thing you see is this glorious view up my skirts, how about you tell us everything?
Well, he stopped for the briefest of seconds. He's caught off guard yet again. And he actually, the pain goes away for just a moment, and you catch that that moment. Okay, I'll tell you anything. Of course, it's dark; you can't see a damn thing anyway. But you manage to get his attention. Okay, and then the pain obviously returns as he's labored in his breath. But all I know is I was hired to get the map, take it back to this guy. He's going to meet us at the tavern tomorrow, midnight. We're supposed to do everything we can to get it from him. It's from some temple way up near the northern edge of the duchy. And it's to some kind of cult that's been uncovered, that's been hidden for hundreds of years or something. And that's all I know. I don't have a name, but he's tall. He's blonde. He's human. He wears chain armor, looks wealthy, purple robes, or not robes, cloak draped over his armor. There's a crest of a lion with a sword behind it on his armor. What else do you want to know? That's all I know. Something like that.
You had mentioned something about a big bag of money. Perhaps you might want to tell me where that is.
Oh, yeah, he's got it. He points to the body over there.
I look over at you guys, or I guess I can't see Aiken, but I look over at Bruin and shrug my shoulders. You think we got enough information from this guy?
And Aiken, I think you're close enough you can see them, right? You can
tell. I saw all that. Yeah.
And kind of hearing all that. What's going on in your neighborhood, by the way? Oh, no, did you say something, Raul, that I missed?
Yes. I want to know where his stash house is.
His stash house?
Yeah. Where he keeps all of his other money, where the hidden and his partner.
We just have an abandoned house over in the downstream. Downriver, the city's kind of divided on a quarters. There's upriver, downriver, and then there's uptown, downtown, and the downriver is kind of the warehousing district, if you will. It's whereas downtown's the slums. Downriver is just not where the better businesses are. Uptown's where the nice businesses are, and upriver's where the nice houses are.
Do you have like an address you can give us?
Yeah, 122 Blow Me Street. No, we don't have a damn address.
Oh my God, the poor guy fell apart.
Yeah, this guy's pissing me off.
Like, he didn't really say
I'm
that.
I'm almost over this, you know. Like.
No, he does not have an address, but he can. There are street names, and he tells you the name of the street is Wayfair, and it's down towards the. And right next to the larder house, something like that.
Is the room trapped? No traps on the doors or anything.
There are no traps. You can have anything you find. Just can I go to the hospital? Can I go to the healer's tent? There's not one not very far away over at the circle. I really need to get help. In the meantime,
what's the name?
Yeah, sorry, go ahead.
what's going on over there, Matt?
Let's see. So while I heard that, I'm wondering, like, either Narsif here has the map and he's lying about it, or he has the map and he doesn't know he has the map, or maybe he, like, is the map, maybe, in some way, because he was abducted, so he's, like, the way to find. So I'm just, I'm gonna...
You're brainstorming?
Yeah, this is what I'm thinking. So I think I'm gonna start asking him, like, so what? You know, why do these guys think you have a map where, and just try to more, but once again, you know, trying to keep it conversational, not interrogating him. So yeah. Like, why do these guys think you have the map?
I don't know why they think I have a map. I've never told anyone I had a map. I don't have a map. I drew one once, but nobody ever paid any attention to it. The bartender at the end, yeah, he just eventually wadded it up and threw it in the fireplace. So I don't get it.
You drew a map? Do you like to draw?
Well, yeah, I don't know that I could draw a straight line right now, but you know, I at times I could draw really well. I enjoy drawing and painting. And he starts rambling off about and pottery and. You know, did I ever tell you I used to
sex
be
in the rain?
Used to be an adventurer, but then I took a spear in the ankle. Oh, yeah, never mind. Go ahead.
Okay. All right. So, I'm assuming that. So when he said that he once drew a map, so is. Am I feeling more strongly that it's not that he has a map, but that he knows the way somewhere and he kind of is the map in a way? Is that?
Do you have any insight skill by any chance?
I'm not trained in it, but
you can obviously
have some insight.
Go for it. Let's. It's time to. Okay. If you want to derive more, are you happy with that?
No, I think I'll pop one on top of that.
All right.
Got it. Freaking Aiken.
So that's just sad, Matt.
I know, seriously.
I mean, I will never forget this day. Normally it would be relatively easy to discern such things, but you basically have to resolve yourself to what you've already said and what you think.
Okay.
I can grant you no further insight into the matter.
Okay. So at this point right now, I'm thinking we want to keep this guy close at least for a little while and maybe get the obviously they don't know what I'm talking about. I'm trying to, you know, I didn't want to scare him and have him run off again and have to chase him down when I'm still bleeding from my wound and stuff. So
right.
So I'm gonna make sure that he's. I think I'm just gonna keep trying to make him happy and you know. Try to befriend this guy so we can find out what's going on.
Sure, understandable. In the meantime, as all this is going down, you start hearing in the distance, it sounds like, you know, kind of the cadence of marching individuals or fast-moving individuals in heavy armor coming from the northeast.
All right, so real quick, I'm going to run up to the other dude. I'm going to whisper, or I'm going to tell him, you shouldn't have raised your blade to my friends. And I'm going to stab it through.
Wait, which dude?
The dude in the black.
The living one, apparently. Again, yeah. It really won't do a lot of good with the dead one.
Yeah, I was going to say, like, you know, Paige looks up at you, because I assume we still have our feet, like, on his chest.
You both side by
side.
Yeah,
if we're still doing that, then I'm just going
to Yeah, and I'm going to say, like, well, he wants to be on his way. Why don't you send him on his way, and I'll walk over towards
Aiken. Just going to stab it, like, into his heart.
So, yeah. Captain and Mrs. Morgan here, as you got your one foot
quick,
up.
I'm going to try to go over to the body and see if I can find that bag of coins.
Gotcha. So you do
anything else useful, you know?
Yeah. So okay, yeah. The stab. Make a quick roll to see if you are able to stab. He will obviously try to defend himself. Okay. His defense is going to be pretty lame. He's severely wounded, yet his chance of defending are pretty... Oh, wow. That was pretty good. But no, didn't matter. You take him out. You know, give him at the very least, mortally wound him. He's dying or dead at this point. In the meantime, you run over to the other one, as you said, and you search, and you do find a small pouch of coins, not anything big. It's a small coin purse. And his sword, of course, is scabbard, and he's wearing leather armor. You don't find anything else really of value or merit.
You have a wineskin?
Yeah, he has a wineskin.
It is a festival night. I'll definitely take that.
Unfortunately, it has water in it. So.
Well, I'll take the bag. I can fill it up with something else.
pour it on him.
So I'm gonna. I want to tell Narsif that we can, we can help him out and keep him away from these people, and that he should stick with us, and sure. And we'll protect him, and then I'll go over to Paige and Ruin and whisper to them, some of the things I heard and say, hey, I think we should keep this guy around. I think this might be might be something big we're on the cusp of here.
Gotcha.
We could make some serious money.
Well, he follows you, of course. He comes up and he stumbles up behind you as you approach. Wait. But he's finishing off the last drops of that wineskin. He's put away a gallon at this point, or whatever a wineskin holds, a lot. And he's finished off that one as you're doing that, and you again still hear the approaching clank of armor, and it's getting very close. And
let's get the hell out of here.
you see torchlight in the distance. There's nothing on the map, but you can just do it in your imagination. And all three of you make a quick perception check, if you don't have prescribed skill in perception, it's a wit check.
I feel terrible. I failed like one.
A 13? Oh, well, 13 is not too bad. That's a pretty good roll.
There's no perception. Only Matt can tell us what's going on.
Oh, there we go. Nice. So, yeah, you, of course, have the vision in the distance. And so as you're getting ready to leave, you look and you can see it is the city watch approaching.
Oh, well, they were the ones that hired us. I mean...
I don't want him questioning this guy though. Maybe we should just slip away and explain ourselves later.
Can I try to loot that other body real quick before we go?
You don't believe you'd have time. You're already seeing their torchlight, which means they're probably seeing your torchlight.
All right. Well,
I am grabbing my daggers and wiping them on him.
Say again.
Yeah.
Grabbing my dagger. That's kind of like the damn thing.
Like yep. I picked up my staff, which was right about where I'm standing, and I'm going to start to walk in whatever direction that away from this.
Yeah, they sound like they're coming. The torchlight and everything you see is basically off in this direction, okay. To the northeast.
So let's go down this way.
If they're wearing heavy armor, they won't be able to. Well, how deep is that little river thing?
It's pretty deep, actually, yeah. I mean, it's not, it's only probably 10, 15 feet across, but it's at least, waist deep, so. It depends on where you cross it, so.
That would severely encumber them if you guys want to just go across that.
Yeah, that's what I was saying. Let's just go across the river.
Take off across
the street. I thought you didn't want to cross it. Yeah, let's go across the street.
All right. And trying to do so without being seen. Correct.
Yeah, I think I'm gonna take Paige's torch and I don't know. Maybe we can like it's like a torch.
Yeah, it's a torch. I'm sorry. There. What was that, Matt? You were saying you were gonna take the
torch. So what I wanted to I know these two. If the torch goes out, I'm not gonna be able to see it all either, right?
I know correct. That. Yes, you can't. Yeah. You can't operate in complete darkness.
I know it's an actual like torch, like it's a flaming stick.
Yeah, it's a flaming stick, yeah.
Okay. So as best as I can, I think I want to take that from Paige and try to like hold it in front of me and then have them all follow close behind me to try to, keep us a little bit less visible.
I'm going to take some of the shadows that are surrounding us and form them into like a, you know, like a convex kind of shape so that it will, from one side, kind of block the light.
Gotcha. As you're leaving, you're going to try and create shadow, create some darkness to reduce the ability to see the light from the outside.
Yeah.
Brilliant. Roll that. Yeah, go ahead and roll that for me. That's the way magic is fun to use here. It's not as good in combat, but it can be if you really blow up the dice. Sure. Spectacular. So, yeah. Are you happy with that?
Yeah, that seems like it's all right.
Yeah, okay, good. So, yeah, you managed to create kind of this shadowy, and Matt, you notice that your range of vision kind of seems to reduce a bit as this the diameter or the radius closes in on you there. So, I won't actually change it in the system, but anyway, it technically does as you're rushing away, and you're leading your.
Yeah, so I want to pick the path and have them like follow single file behind me and just try to, you know, keeping the light in front of me and hoping that they're able to follow in my steps.
Understood. Yeah. All right, and go ahead and make a stealth check for me there, if you would, sir, to pick the proper path. I'm assuming you want to. Do so in such a way that will help you get away. Sounds like a stealth check to me. We don't have to worry about the tokens too much here. This is more an imagination than anything else. You happy with that, sir?
Yeah.
Good, good. All right, so yeah, you guys get across the stream. You get to, you know, the large section of the this park is rather huge. It's, you know, several hundred yards by several hundred yards. And you get to, you know, the farthest edge of it. And you believe you may have lost them. You don't see any torchlight. You did not hear them splash through the stream. And they don't appear to have heard you do so either. So you picked a spot where you could cross in a rather shallow area where it didn't create a lot of sound. But at the same time, you were... you know, trying to cover your tracks as well. So, having said that, they could possibly track you. So, to you.
Okay. Once we're far enough away, can I? I think I'll hand the torch back to Paige and then use my my woodsman skills to maybe try to like hide our tracks just in case they're following us.
Gotcha. Do you have any skill in nature or something similar?
Yeah.
There you go.
I know things.
You know some things about this, some stuff.
Yeah.
And are you happy with that role?
Yeah, I'll stick with that.
Okay. So yeah, you take some time. You make sure that once you're safely across the stream, you take a. Double back on your steps a little bit, make a surreptitious path and grab a tree limb and, you know, start wiping out your tracks at critical points and try to make it where it's hard to follow you. But you have to do so hastily, you feel like. So it's not like you can take a lot of time to do it. So
okay.
it's a quick... I mean, you were the ranger, right? So you tell me.
Yeah, no, I want to do a hasty thing, and then I want to say to everybody, I think we should get back into the city and find our way to an inn or somewhere where we can be nondescript, kind of try to blend in with the festivities going on tonight.
Sure.
Why not take that guy's place? Remember, he gave us an address or location.
Yeah, I was thinking maybe we should go check out that place.
So I want to have a whispered conversation with Paige and Ruin, and I know Narsif's pretty inebriated right now. And,
yeah, he's just about gone.
So I want to say maybe we should go somewhere else and maybe have a map drawing competition with this guy and see what comes out or something. Because I think this guy knows more than he knows he knows.
We should strip him down and see if he's got any tattoos he doesn't know about.
Well, we can do that later once he's passed out. But
what the hell was that all about?
Well, you know, he might have like a scar branded on his back or something like that. Yeah.
That would be exactly like something that a sick cultist would do.
Okay. Yeah, so. I got you. I'm just thinking, what kind of sick drinking game is this? Are you talking about what the hell?
And I'm definitely like talking, like trying to be very clear with Ruin, saying, you know, let's be friendly to this guy for, you know, at least the foreseeable future. I don't know much about him, but I don't think he's evil or worth killing or anything. But I think he has a lot of information that he doesn't really know he has.
So. Right.
Well, the particular location was because we don't actually have a location. So if we're seeing around normal areas with Aiken, and if he's tied to this, then they're going to come.
What'd you call him?
Aiken. Or I don't know what the drunk's name is.
What's
the
Narsif or
something? Yes.
Yeah,
Narsif. Sorry, she called him Negan. Oh, by the way, he grabs his baseball bat. Yeah. Really? Okay. Well, you've been in town.
The guy calls a lot of attention to himself.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know if it'd be good to bring him in.
Just think of the narcissist.
Normal in area.
So he's Narsif the narcissist.
Yeah, I think I can handle him a bit, and I think we can. I think the fact that there's basically a big party going on in the city tonight might make him less obvious. Yeah.
Tonight's the kind of night people. You would be nice to a drunk.
Yeah.
We're all drugs tonight.
You're fairly knowledgeable of the city. I mean, you've all been here at least 6 months.
Yeah.
And so you kind of know your way around. You don't know every building or business. Obviously, it's a big place. But you know enough that if you needed to go a particular place, you had something in mind, you could probably find it.
So is it Mardi Gras style?
No, it's like certain areas of town are out in the streets. So, yeah, it's a block party kind of thing. But it's spread out. It's not everywhere in the town.
Because remember, we're also bleeding or have wounds. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, we should. Yeah, we should find like an alleyway or something where we can maybe clean ourselves up a bit.
Oh yeah, this river could wash away a lot of that, though. You know. Yeah.
Well, we can't. We couldn't stop. We moved right through that. We're beyond that now.
Oh okay.
So. Yeah, you ignore the map because you're technically not on this map anymore.
Well, I hold up the coins that I stole from that guy, and I say, well, it looks like our new friends want to buy us a drink. What do you guys say?
Interesting. So sure, yeah. How do you guys react to that idea?
Oh yeah, no, I'm into that. I'm gonna suggest, since we know the city pretty well, I'm gonna try to remember So you guys got the name of the inn where we were where these baddies were supposed to take the map once they were done, or did you not get that information from him before you killed him?
I feel like we did, but now that you mention it, I can't remember what the name is, so that could be a negative.
Even if you did, you don't remember now.
We didn't get that specific information.
I don't think you got the information to begin with.
Based on the description, it wouldn't be hard to find it.
Yeah, we could pick the guy out of a crowd, you know, if we saw him. So.
Yeah, it's a big city, but I don't know. We can at least Narsif might know that anyway. But I think we should just try to find a place that we know is like nondescript, but where there's a lot of people around, where we won't get, you know, where we'll blend in. After we clean ourselves up, where, you know, we'll just look like members of the crowd. We won't stand out, and it won't be too quiet either.
I think, Paul, I don't know, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but I think there's a tavern not too far away from here who I'm sort of friendly with the bartender.
You know, that's really good. I like that. Yeah, give yourself a character point for that creative self-storytelling there. Yeah. And in fact,
you
are.
I don't know why, he just really
likes me. I don't either, but something about dancing on the bar in that upskirt you gave him, you seem to do that in the right conditions.
Well, I'm just very sorry that way.
I still try to get that out of my mind. I'm like, hey, Captain Morgan, don't you look. So anyway, yes, you do recall. It's this, you know, this place would be perfect because it's kind of out of the way. It's down the stream from where you were, down where it starts getting into the more of the sewery area where the stream runs behind this place, but people throw trash in it. And
the
it's not
so
it's not
there.
drinks are very cheap, and they are actually quite better because the food is horrible. There's this half orc named Grygog, if you recall, and it's got this windmill on top of the tavern. It's this really cool. I mean, the only reason anybody ever goes there is because it's so cool inside. Supposedly, he invested in some type of when he quit adventuring himself. He invested in the inn, and he had some like fans installed, almost like ceiling fans, which is kind of crazy, and it's attached to a windmill on the building. Anyway, you know this place because in the heat of this subtropical climate that you're in, you're in the heat of the day. This is a great place to hang out just for the cool that comes in from his contraption. So, awesome. Sounds familiar.
What's the name of this place?
It's called the Windy Tavern, the Windy Tavern.
Okay.
The good old Windy. Let's go
to the Windy.
Yeah, you don't expect there'll be a lot of people in there tonight. So, people tend to go where the food and is better when they're going to party like this. So, but the drinks are cheap.
But probably Paige watered is down friendly too. But Paige is friendly with Grygog, right? So we know that we'll have privacy, and he won't let the. He'll be looking out for like eavesdroppers and.
Yep.
Old Grygog, he owes me a couple of favors.
He actually owes you a meal.
Remember that night.
If you recall, you did a delivery. You took a delivery for him. Some things at the wharf. Oh. You guys arranged a cart. You brought him. Oh, that guy, yeah. So you took a delivery for him and delivered some stuff. And, so it actually worked for him, but he didn't pay you in coins. He pays you in food, which sucks. But, you know, you typically took it out and drink and just had liquid food there. So, anyway, so, yeah, that's a great place to kind of hang out. And sure enough, you get there, and there's nobody in the place. It's absolutely empty. There is some revelry going on in the streets nearby. You can hear some cheering, and there's the occasional bang of, fireworks, if you will. If you want to call it, that's probably magic, actually. But there's an occasional brilliant display of color in the sky. But you've got the place to yourself, and it's pretty much straight up tavern. Nothing strange there. A big long bar with about 12 seats, several tables, roughly square building.
And so on our way there, did we take a pause? I kind of wanted to try to patch myself up a little bit more.
Well, yeah, I tell you what you do.
Clean ourselves up.
When you get there, you kind of been working your way through the alleys and the back ways to get there. You're at the point where you know you need to stop just before you go inside and clean up or do whatever you want to do. And there's a big water barrel out the back where the runoff water comes off the top of the roof into a big barrel where you can use it to kind of wash with rainwater.
Okay. Can I try to heal myself up again?
Yeah, sure you can.
I'm hurting pretty bad.
No, you don't. Your healer's kit has been expended.
I'm aware of that. So
you're just doing basic bandaging.
I still have some skills.
Some skills.
So, out of curiosity,
don't think that in it,
because we are still on job. So I'm curious about: have we worked with the Night Watch before?
No.
Like, what are our orders when it comes to our shift? What do you do after the shift?
Yeah, you were pretty much told to just kind of keep the peace and respond to anything happening in the park. And the idea was to do so until, dawn.
Were we paid in advance?
You were.
Idiots. All right. So I can add 2 silver onto my onto my gold.
Sure.
Okay.
So we don't have to report back either, though, right?
There was no expectation for you to report unless you encountered something that needed to be reported. Right. It's not like they do they don't do paperwork.
No, I was kind of worried since the place where those people fell ill happened to be where we were assigned. Were we the only team assigned there?
As far as you know, to the park, yeah.
Kind of helps draw conclusions kind of quickly.
There's every reason to believe they were on their way to where you were. It looked like they were coming straight at you. There's no reason to believe they would have not found the bodies.
Yeah.
But I guess they could have. What's that, Matt?
Well, so I clumsily attempted to heal myself again, and then...
that's your extra character point roll?
Should I do it?
Yeah.
want me to believe?
It doesn't look like I got it, though, did I?
Yeah. Yeah, you're going from a 2 to a 1, right?
Oh, am I? Okay.
Yeah. You only needed a 15? Let me double check.
I think it's a 15. That first one was a... I hate to do this to myself, but that first one I crit failed on the first die, so...
Yeah. Oh, yeah, so you're 10, you're 18 now. So, yeah, you got it.
I got it.
No, 5, 6, 7... 15. You got it exactly. 15.
I got it exactly. Okay, yeah. So that was lucky. All right, yeah.
So, Paul, I was just stunned, right? I don't need to try to heal myself or anything?
That is correct. The stun works the same as a wound level 1, so you're minus 1 to all your actions, if you will, technically. However, it automatically heals itself after a round.
Okay, cool.
So it's just a temporary condition.
Well, before we go in, I'd Fine. Like to... oh, sorry. Go ahead, Raul.
No, I'm sorry.
Before we go in... Oh, sorry.
Well, we'll okay, go first.
I'm doing it on purpose now. Go ahead.
Okay, well, before we go in, I want to activate my old charming aura that makes everybody so amiable.
Oh, I got you. So, let me see. You want to prepare yourself with one of your advantages here. And you've been...
My mind is...
Well, it's just natural, so okay. So, yeah.
I have an extra normal ability for charming.
Oh, you're wanting to use the extra normal.
Yeah, I was hoping I could, you know. That way, what Narsif might be a little bit more inclined to answer our questions that way.
I gotcha. What is the actual effect? Are you trying to manipulate his personal opinion of you? Are you changing your appearance? Are you... supplementing your verbal skills with
basically like all of a sudden like I look like a little bit prettier, my voice sounds a little bit sweeter, you know, there's like a
his beer goggles.
Exactly, there's a little glint in the eye, you know, like a
plus 5 beer goggles. Corona, give yourself a point. I like that.
I just, you know, I seem just a little friendlier.
I would kind of assume we would adapt the role of, like, a group of people kind of wandering off the street, out of the party, you know, kind of hands over each other, and we'll have Paige's character next to, damn it, I can't never remember his name.
Narsif?
Narcolepsy guy.
Narcolepsy. All of a sudden, he falls asleep.
And we'll just kind of wander in like a, you know, kind of like a college group of kids drunk, you know, hopping, bar hopping.
Very good. Obviously, Ruin kind of surprises you all. He suddenly, his persona changes and he takes on this, it goes from this, you know, ninja warrior thing you saw happening in the park, being all secretive and tactical to this. Hey guys, and he just comes, runs, puts his arm around everybody, and he grabs Narcissus. Hey man, it was such a good time. And he's just like, what the hell just happened? You know, like, dude, you got multiple personalities? What the hell? Having said so, it seems to be bolstering what you're doing. So roll your spell. Let's make sure that you get that illusionary beer goggle effect you're looking for. Are you happy with that roll?
Yeah, it seems all right.
Oh, yeah, that's a good one. So yeah, these are only moderately difficult things you're trying to do. So usually your range is 11 to 15, and you've been nailing it. So just so you know. And sure enough, yeah, you guys notice this is not something she did just for his benefit. You notice that this, she kind of just does that around her body, and there's just a change. She looks, whatever you like, she looks like it.
And I say to Ruin, I say, how would you like to buy me a drink?
All of a sudden, Ruin likes blondes, and she looks blonde, you know? I was like, what the hell? How'd you do that? But at the same time, Aiken's into guys, so she looks like a guy. Like, suddenly gets masculine features.
No, Paige and I have been hanging out. I know what's going on. So all I do is just, I just look at her and shake it off, take another long drink.
Fair enough. Very good.
Hey, there's enough page to go around. Don't worry.
Wow. Actually, after I realize what she's doing, I nudge Narsif like closer to her. And,
yeah.
I'm trying to get him more malleable.
Well, he's pretty gone, but he takes notice. And you guys stumble into the bar under this pretense of revelry, and your good friend the bartender is like, "Hey, guys, come in! Finally, someone, come on! What do you want?" And he's apparently by himself. He doesn't have his wait staff. It's nobody's in here, so he's sent his bar barmaid's home.
It's the festival, and your bar's empty.
He's empty. Yeah. This place. When I say the food's bad, it's bad.
Well, so, I feel like we need to get Narsif a little bit more sober. Maybe we should buy him some terrible food, and maybe he'll vomit a little bit, or
sober him up a little bit.
Sober, yeah.
I'm gonna talk to Gregog and hand him a silver for our drinks for as long as that lasts, and I'm gonna ask him if I can poke around his kitchen and maybe try to make some sort of sobering elixir for Narsif to bring him back.
Oh yeah. He'll even give you some guidance. He'll tell you what he thinks you should use, which you immediately know better. then again, she does want him to vomit. So maybe you could take some guidance from the cook. But in any case, yeah, he takes silver and he's like, "Oh, yeah, all right." He puts that in his vest pocket. He's got a little vest and sticks it in his pocket. And he's thrilled. All right, and he starts just bringing out the booze and throwing bread and cheese. And the bread's hard. The cheese is moldy, and I don't mean a likable moldy.
And he's cut off a few layers.
Yeah, you might want to clean it down a little bit before you bite into that stuff. And he starts just setting stuff up and invites you behind the counter to do whatever you need to do.
Okay.
Good, good, good. So as you're doing that, as you're preparing his concoction there, Aiken, what are the other two of you doing?
Is the actual bartender going back with Matt's character? Or is he still manning?
He's kind of back and forth. He goes back and forth. He goes back. He grabbed the plate of cheese and brought it out. He grabbed the bread from under the bar. But he's,
Okay.
If you're trying to do something when he's not paying attention, that would not be difficult to time.
No. It'd be more of just getting a room for us.
Oh, it's just a tavern, not an inn. I apologize.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, I'm guzzling beer and stuffing my face with cheese.
Of course, yeah. In the meantime, he's. He's what are we giving him? He's I need a beer, I need an ale. Where's mine?
Oh yeah, that was for all of us.
Yeah.
Okay.
So yeah.
So you're gonna sober him up by giving him more alcohol.
Maybe you should water that down or something back there.
So this is his pitcher. Yeah, this is the worst ale I've ever tasted. It tastes like water.
Oh, well, you can't complain, Narsif. It's cheap and it's free for you because you're our friend, so
At this point, yeah, his taste buds are kind of numb anyway, so he's okay. He can deal with it. You've convinced him. All right, so any ideas about what this concoction is going to be made of there?
So I need to use my – I know this isn't the best kitchen in the world, but they might have spices and herbs and stuff, and maybe whatever remnants I have left over from my healing kit. What I want to aim for is something that's going to sober him up enough to communicate, but also leave him, still happy. Gotcha. And so that he still kind of wants to answer our questions.
Yeah, unfortunately, you're really struggling to find anything you think would make him happy in this kitchen. There's a definitive lack of spices. It doesn't even appear to be salt. No wonder the food tastes like shit. Okay. There's nothing to benefit from what's back there. It's just, raw ingredients and they're not fresh. And get where you're going with that, but you spend some time digging through shit and God almighty, no wonder this shit doesn't taste good. You just,
Okay. All right, so I'm going to I'll go back to the table then and shake my head, and then maybe suggest we wait till morning, or not sure.
Yeah, don't ask Corona. He'll waterboard him.
Yeah, what time is it? Like at night? Like how close were we to the end of our shift?
Not very. Yeah, it's probably
okay. So
at best 1:30, 2:00 at this point.
Ask the bartender. Well, I think we should know by now the closest inn from here.
Oh yeah,
like CDN, I guess.
Yeah, you could be there in, you know, on foot, stumbling, staggering. You could be there in 10 minutes or less.
So there's no rooms here. This is just a bar.
This is just a bar, yeah. But it was the closest place that you thought you'd get to that you almost sure would be quiet and could have a conversation.
Okay. Well, maybe we should try to see what we can get out of this guy while we got him.
Okay, so how... I'm just gonna ask him anyway. If hey, you remember that map you mentioned? I wonder if I know the area or know anything about it. That map you drew for that other bartender, that the jerk that threw it in the fire afterwards.
I'm a laugh. He says this bartender.
No, he knows.
I'll pull out my notebook and pass it to him and see if he'll draw it for us again.
You have a notebook?
Who doesn't have a notebook? I thought that was a given.
It's a 5-star. What are you talking about? It's college rule.
What?
I've got paper and pens and ink and stuff.
There we go.
Which she paid for.
Yeah.
Matt's notebook is actually a tree bark.
He assumed he had pants too, but that's what I'm
playing. I know. You made me buy pants. And the pants weren't even on the list. So technically, guys, none of us are wearing pants because there were no pants to be bought.
If you recall, the tunics come with a matching set of pants.
Yeah, you say that, but it's tunic. Yeah, okay.
Well, the thought, you said that you didn't want Natalia sure he would wear them anyway.
How should the tunic?
just depends on what time of night it is.
Yeah, there you go. how inebriated you are. Yeah, I got you. Okay. So you start looking around for your notebook that you seem to forgot to purchase, and Paige produces parchment and paper and quill and ink and everything. He goes, "Oh yeah," and he starts drawing, and he draws a map, and it's rough, but it gives you an idea of how, you know, basically going almost due north of where you are. He draws a big heavy line and says, "Oh, that right there is the edge of the duchy right here." So, you know, basically you're right on the edge of the duchy of Rodolfo, and the one right to the north, which is Ryagog, is the name of it. So, and it's right on the edge, right there. They're basically, what you do know about town, there are kind of two roads that come out of town and go at a V, you know, kind of northwest and northeast. And this appears to be directly in between the two, right at the imaginary line where the kingdom ends. He explains, and he draws this kind of a circle, like a mountain, if you will, but he explains that there's a big crater. It's this foothill, if you will. So it's, you know, the elevation's not huge, but it's still, it could be, 1,000 feet of elevation. And up at the top of this thing, there was always this big heavy forest, and nobody ever, you know, nobody's ever gotten to the top before. Nobody, I guess, really realized that they just, no matter which way you came up on this mountain, or this big hill, you would encounter this impassable foliage. But really, that's a magical hedge. It's a magical barrier to where the cult lives. And they've been there for hundreds of years. And they bring down the barrier long enough to come out and attack people and take them in. And they're cannibals. And they do experiments. And they torture you. And about that time, he goes,
Man, that sounds terrible.
Where's my drink?
Yeah, well, let me get that for you. So how do you think you found your way in there? Like, is there something special that you did to get it? Like, what happened? How'd you get up there?
I don't know. They abducted me. They came out of the trees and they got me and they drug me in there. And, you know, I've been drinking a little bit that day. I don't do it all the time, but they overwhelmed me. And the next thing I know, I see these tables where they strap you down and they poke you with stuff. And they were big women. Oh, my. Not beautiful like you, of course, but
oh, so sweet.
But yeah, but you know what? You look pretty good. You know, and he gets distracted again. And he starts he's like, yeah. And you were out there in the woods, weren't you, doing the magic stuff? Yeah.
Oh, he's I don't know about that. But these women, they seem like, man, that's just so terrible that happened to you. I rub his arm a little bit and I say, what else can you tell me? This is such an interesting story.
Oh, you want to hear my story? Oh, okay, yeah. Nobody ever wants to hear my story. Really? Oh, well, I should buy you a drink. Bartender, get her a drink. On me. You know, and, you know, he's oblivious.
You're too kind.
So, anybody else doing anything as this repartee is going on?
I'm just listening. She seems to have him on a roll, so I don't want to say anything to interrupt it.
Watch her and talk to the bartender.
I'll try to distract him from the conversation and get him away from it. Oh, that's good news. Nice.
Especially the stuff about the woods.
Clever, yeah. Come over here. Let me tell you about anything particular you're going to talk about?
Actually, ways to improve his business.
Oh, kind of a business consultation.
Yes.
And again, guys, you see this demeanor change in Ruin. Well, all of a sudden, he gets very businesslike and very authoritative. And he's like, it's a commanding voice, but in a respectful way. He says, hey, I need to talk to you. I've got these great ideas. I've been thinking a lot about it. And he suddenly becomes this leader, if you will. And you, what? And anyway, you just, for a brief moment, you catch yourself doing a double take. It's almost like he did a spell on himself.
That's some impressive stuff over there.
It's this person. He's got multiple personalities, I guarantee it. But maybe not. You have to figure
turn the page and say, this guy's creepy.
Ignore him.
Think what you like, Aiken. I sort of like him.
You would.
Wow. Poor voice. Yep.
And I say to Aiken, don't be jealous, love.
Oh, my God. Okay. So you continue to ply him. And, of course, what was the last question? I've lost. I forgot what you asked me.
So how did you get away?
Oh, yeah. One of the shackles had me up in this corner hanging up, and it was loose. I don't know how, if they messed up locking or something, and I realized it. So I was able to, there was all kinds of stuff on the floor. I found a piece of metal and I jimmied. Took a long time, but eventually I got out and I got away. But then I got to the blame hedge and it was closed. It's like, so I got ready to try and figure out how to way to climb through it, and it just opened up. I don't know why, and I ran through, and I was out.
That's an amazing story. You must be so brave and lucky.
Oh, well, yeah. Nobody's ever called me that. Called me crazy, but, you know. Anyway, yeah, brave and lucky. How lucky?
You think we'll just see, and I can hand him another drink.
Yeah. Okay. He starts sniffing himself and takes the alcohol out of the thing and, you know.
I want to whisper to Paige, maybe we should try to find out why other people are so interested in this place. So everybody thinks he's crazy, but maybe he's not so crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, he obviously told the story to the wrong person, or somebody got wind of it. So.
I know. I was saying, you know, ask him. You got the edge right now.
It's better coming from you.
A narcissist. Yeah. I mean, this is such an interesting story. I imagine that you've told a lot of people. I mean, if it happened to me, gosh, I would tell lots of people because, you know, how brave and lucky. And can you remember, like, you know, did you tell this story to anybody recently? Can you remember, like, were you in a certain tavern or anything? Were you telling this story? And
he's like searching his thinking, I don't know. I've told so many people all the time. And most of the time, it's new people that I've never met before. Because everybody else, as soon as they see me, they kind of go the other way. So, I mean, I've told all kinds of people the story. I don't know why it made these guys so crazy.
Do you remember where you were yesterday or earlier today?
I was in the park drinking.
Do you remember where you were before that?
No, actually, I don't. So, yeah, he's too far removed. His memory is not very far reaching at the moment.
Oh, ask him about that, the armor with the lion and the sword. Ask him if he knows about that.
Oh, yeah. Hey, I heard about this guy. Maybe you've seen him. I heard there's a new stranger in town, and maybe you've seen him. He's a big guy, and I think he's blonde, and he's got, chainmail armor, and he's got, like, a crest with, like, a purple lion. Do you remember seeing, like, a purple lion anywhere recently?
A purple lion. I remember a big blonde guy with armor, but the lion wasn't purple.
Okay.
What color was the lion?
Yellow, I think, yeah. So let's take a quick break, and we'll be right back.
All right.
Okay, yeah, you were asking about the individual he saw, and he says he's, I remember he had a big yellow crest on their breast, and the lion.
That's sword. So interesting.
He liked my story.
Interesting. And I look at and I look into his eyes, and I say, can you tell me what color my eyes are?
Oh, no, I can't, but they are beautiful.
Thank you. That's so sweet. If you had to guess a color, what would you say?
What color does he see? Because
I can't remember. They're blue. I just wanted to see if he was colorblind.
I got that. I'm like, is that on the character sheet? I don't remember that on the character sheet. Let's see how he. They look the most beautiful. Hang on, I gotta roll for this. This is just too priceless.
They're beautiful. All four of them are just gorgeous.
I get that a lot.
They're sapphire blue. So yeah, he can tell.
Okay. Interesting. No, okay, so you did say purple though, right?
No, I see. I
didn't hear that wrong. Purple cloak. Okay, thanks. Purple cloak. Okay.
Yeah, that's all right. Good. That's it. Man, we forget things in real life or mishear them all the time. So that's awesome. And Mr. Ruin, you're on mute, sir.
Pshaw.
Okay, so now what? He's starting to get to that point that, if he's not making any advances, he's starting to look sleepy.
I think maybe we should.
He's getting a little touchy-feely, too. So he's like, Trying to see what testing his limits.
I think we should find a place where we can all pass out for the night and then see if we can get anything else out of this guy in the morning and then maybe move on after that.
That sounds good.
Fair enough.
I'll, of course, be wanting my own room.
Of course. So you can certainly find a place that you can rent a room. And the concern is the cost of all nights, of course, night would be more expensive than most when it comes to this kind of thing because of the festivities and there are visitors in town. And it's like anywhere else, the rooms are going to be more pricey under these circumstances. So it's going to cost you a couple silver for a room tonight.
Man, that's pricey. So how much was in that little bag?
Sure, we don't want to go to that one place.
Say that again. I'm sorry. I didn't hear you.
It's like, I'm sure you don't want, we don't want to go to that one place that's free.
No, yeah, I heard that.
How much did we get off the guy that that pay dropped?
Oh, yeah. Good.
Or looted, rather. I guess you didn't rob him. You can't really rob someone.
He was already dead. Yeah. He wasn't
even that wasn't even a guy.
So it's
just the bottom half.
You got 4 silver pieces and 25 copper pieces.
Well, easy come, easy go. Let's just get a room.
What? There's a free place, though?
No,
yeah.
We there's that place that they told us that they like they're like flop house or wherever where they stash their stuff. We could check that out if you guys want to.
And you could probably get a room in a common house, you know, like a common room where you're sleeping with lots of people, in a place like that for, you know, maybe 3 copper. You know, you don't have to go with a private room like she was suggesting. But.
Let's go camp out. Whatever, it's your silver. I'm not buying my own room, though.
I'm sleeping in the common room.
Well, what do you think, Ruin?
I would take the free place, but just in case they have any other stuff.
Yeah, let's go check it out.
Okay.
Plus, they won't be using it.
I mean, we do have this, like, super drunk dude with us, so, like, that could...
It depends on how far, I guess, it is, and...
We can just knock him out if we need to.
It's in the kind of shady part of town, so you're gonna be a good, you know, 20 minutes getting there, maybe 30.
Okay, so we'll just go to the... I don't know if you guys want to go to a common place, but it'd be up to you guys. Because we can go out of town if it's easier.
Or we buy one room and Paige, you can have the bed.
Yeah.
Acceptable.
All right. Everybody else sleeping on the floor.
Yeah, I'm with me. Fine. I don't care. Yeah, I don't think Narsif knows enough to care.
On any day other than
enough to care.
And on any day other than the festival day, you'd probably get some odd looks trying to all four of you cram into one room, but not party night. Not with the likes of Paige. She's, you know, flamboyant. Yeah.
We'll just have to roll with that.
You get an interesting look from the innkeeper, like, here's the key. He's kind of a weirdo. Yeah. Anyway.
Paige just looks like she got really lucky tonight.
That's right. It was Paige who got really lucky. Okay, so you guys make your way to the room. Nothing fancy. This is just a rather plain room, but it is a private room. It's not very big for all of you. It's gonna be interesting, you know, piling up on the floor. But you got your bedrolls and things, so you make it work.
We just kind of knock Narsif over and then like push him underneath the bed to sleep, so he's out of the way. Yeah.
Once he's down prone, he's snoring instantly, and he won't care. Hanging from the rafters, he probably wouldn't care. He's out.
Excellent.
So, all right. Any preparations? Anybody doing anything before bed or first thing when they wake up?
Before bed, checking the place for traps.
I want to
check in the room for traps.
Paranoid much?
Wow. Yes.
Check for secret doors.
Detect magic.
But yes, that's what I will be doing first.
Go for it. Roll it. Yeah. In the meantime, go ahead, Matt.
I'm just going to go ahead and try to patch myself up a bit more.
Sure. Make another healing group.
Crappy small room, but it'll work.
Oh, no, that's good enough for one, too, isn't it? Is it? I can't remember.
Oh, yeah.
All right, that's good. So I'm stunned now.
Can I help?
That just goes away after.
That's going to go away. Yeah, you're done.
Can I try to like help Matt at all, like or Aiken?
I don't need it. Got it.
He's good. Okay.
Yeah. Cool.
Yeah, he's good.
Thank you, though.
Oops, unable to read. What did I do? I clicked the wrong button. Well, quit giving me an error message. Okay. So he's good.
A pair of rolling ones tonight.
Having said that, Ruin is still wounded, and so is Nassif.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm going to try to help Ruin.
Yeah, I could have healed myself.
I'm not like super good at it, but I'll give it a shot.
I can patch him up. I'm better at that, right? I can still do that, Paul. Is that correct?
Yeah, it's a different target.
Just my regular.
You're just using regular bandaging, heal.
Making bandages. I don't think I would let them.
Well, I'll ask you. Hey, man, you want some help?
I would probably do it myself. Yeah.
Okay. Well, I'll leave him alone. I'll try to patch up Narsif though while he's passed out.
Go for it. Do no harm. Good with that?
Yeah, I think I'm good with that.
That work?
And you're good with yours, Raul?
Yeah, 19.
Yeah, I think your target's what, 10? Yep.
Yeah, there's 10 for everybody, right?
Yep, it's good. Yeah, the targets are the same, unless there's some mitigating circumstances like poison or disease or something. But all right, good, good. Yeah, you guys are able to easily bandage everybody up, get you back to the point that you're no longer so severely wounded.
And then continuing on with my paranoia.
Yes, yes, do your search, of course.
I did a search, it was just 10.
To reset from the server, there's been a problem with your session. So you guys are not interesting. Refreshing here. So
nobody's got a wound anymore, right?
Is it? Are you seeing them on the screen or no?
I still see them. I was just just curious.
I've cleared them all. For some reason, it's not updating it online, but that's okay. I'm gonna refresh.
Yeah, online. Which is kind of weird because the other one should be lagged, not this one.
Yeah, this is really strange.
Yeah, okay. I think the server link was messed up or something. Although the roles were working, which is weird. Yeah. Didn't update it.
Didn't update anything. Okay, weird. Okay. Well, we're kind of getting to a stopping point anyway. You guys waking up the next day. Is there anything you needed to do overnight or any preparations I need to do about before we entered into the due day?
I was just locking the door and putting daggers like over the door and over the window, so
like jamming them into the wow.
I told you my character has quirks.
That he does. Very good. Okay, well let's kind of call it there. Everybody give yourself 2 character points at the end to just, you know, for end of session meeting the goals that you had set forth so far. Well, I don't know that you really, your goal was to get into all that and end up in an inn sleeping on the floor, but.
An inn is better than the other option.
You survived.
I'm fine with that. I almost died, so I'm fine with that.
Good. So we'll get back together in a couple of weeks and we'll certainly, let me see if I can throw up a quick set of credits here for those who, if that doesn't work, we'll do it another way.
So we started with, what, 10 character points?
I have no 5, I think.
5? Okay.
Yeah.
Just trying to have an understanding where we're at. Okay.
So, yeah. Well, I can't get the credits to roll, but I'll do that in a second. So,
So ladies and gentlemen, this is GM Pyro. This has been our first ever episode of ITHERVERSE the Channel presents A Blight of Souls. Hope you've enjoyed what we've done so far. There's much, much more to come. We certainly know we made a few mistakes along the way. I have certainly made quite a few, and we'll get those corrected in this interactive playtest. As I mentioned before, please go to ITHERVERSE.com. That's with an I. It's right there at the bottom left hand of your screen. Go to ITHERVERSE.com. Check out everything that we've got going on. But more than anything, find ways to reach out to us. Send us emails. We'll be looking at setting up wikis and blogs and a lot of other things in the future. So stay in touch. I want to make sure you are interacting and letting us know what you think of what we're doing. And more importantly, what it is that you would like to see to come. Give us your ideas. Give us your commentary. We'd love to share it. I'll certainly give you a verbal credit if I can of anything I use that you might suggest. So we look forward to seeing you online, and it's been quite a pleasure. So that's it for ITHERVERSE the Channel. Catch you next time.